Alright, welcome to One Night in Karazhan's card review. Today we're going to be at the EXP bar owned by Brian himself. So thank you for letting us use your facility to record this.
Absolutely, yeah, thanks very much for coming down.
Yeah, I really love this bar. Like, it's very game kind of themed. I actually never knew that it was that. Yeah, this is my first time actually.
Oh, hey. Okay,
yeah,
cool.
Yes, but it's really neat. Like, there's so many things that you can do here. You can actually game here and a lot of things.
Yeah, we got a whole wall of board games.
Yeah,
we
also
have a bunch of games set up, typically fighting games because they're a lot easier to set up and challenge people to. And then we got an arcade machine behind us and also a Sega Genesis emulator with 80 games. So we got a lot of stuff going on, but typically we've been around for 4 years, actually.
Four years. And I never came in those 4 years.
Hey, man, we don't really advertise. It's all word of mouth. We've been surviving on it. And we, you know, our food's great. Our drinks are good. It's just a matter of, like, you know, keeping the dream alive, you know, bringing the community together.
Yeah,
that's what we
want
to do, and that's what we're doing.
Yeah, that's great, because in Vancouver, BC right now, there's just so little of the gaming community, so it's great. It's great that you're doing it, because it's almost non-existent. So, have you heard of the new Hearthstone expansion?
Absolutely, I have.
What do you think about it? Do you play Hearthstone yourself?
I played Hearthstone a good deal when it came out.
I've since
dropped off quite a bit. Not that I don't like the game, but it's definitely like, I have so many to keep trying to stay relevant. To be like, what do I need to do here in the restaurant, you know, that kind of thing. Like right now, No Man's Sky was like all the hype. Now people are like,
No Man's Sky,
I'm typically a fighting gamer competitively, like, you know, that's what I do. So I go to Evo and enjoy competing down there. That's a good time. But yeah, I love Hearthstone, but I don't know too much about the new expansion. I'm excited to see if it'll like bring me back.
It's like a party, man. It's like a party. One Night in Karazhan.
Yeah,
although I don't play WoW myself, but the teaser was pretty dope. Are you planning to host any Hearthstone tournaments in the future or anything like that?
You know, I'm happy to do it.
Happy to do it?
We actually still have some official swag from some of the old Hearthstone fireside gatherings.
Yeah.
And we had a good time with that. So I still have some swag to give away. I would love to give it away. We're just kind of waiting for a good launch. And we wanted to do something for this launch as well. So, I mean, keep an eye on our Facebook and Twitter. We might do something.
Oh, that's sweet. So, do you have any last words for ESP?
You can come down anytime. We open at 5 p.m. every day. If you are watching this within the local area, it's expbar.ca. Otherwise, you know, if you're in the area, come visit us. And we're happy to be a community hub for everybody involved.
Sweet. Thanks, Brian. So definitely come to the EXP bar. I'll probably be coming here most of the time,
having
a few drinks. Thank you so much. You too.
All right. Welcome to the One Night in Karazhan card review. So you have myself, Hermes, Kraxximus, and King of Kimchi. So a little bit about myself. I host HCT open tournaments in the Hearthstone community, and also I have a YouTube channel that provides certain card deck reviews and guides as well for the community who wants to learn how to play certain decks. So today we're going to do a card review. We have two very competent players who participate in a lot of the local tournaments in Vancouver, BC, and they're also legend players as well. So you want to talk a little bit about your experiences?
Sure. I've been playing the game since beta and played quite a bit. I really enjoyed the game, and eventually when Legendary became a thing, I started hitting it consistently, and then I started playing tournaments. And I started consistently placing quite high up there, not quite top, but good enough. And when the HCT Spring Preliminaries became a thing, I decided that's when I really wanted to try, and I tried hard. And I got top 100 twice. And it felt pretty good. And then there was a Tavern Hero qualifier, and I went for that. And I got it, and it felt pretty good. So, I just like playing the game. I played in the preliminaries, got knocked out real quick, but hey, that's how it is. That was fun stuff.
Learned something.
Oh, yeah.
And so, my Hearthstone experience is also pretty similar to Kraxximus. I started playing pretty early in the closed beta, and I started getting into competitive Hearthstone in my first year of university by joining the UBC Esports Collegiate Team. And we made it pretty far into the playoffs. We actually took first place where we played in the finals at DreamHack Austin. And shortly after that, I also participated in the prelims, as Kraxximus over here said, with other top local Vancouver Hearthstone players. And we, two of us actually finished really high in the top 25. And that's pretty much the summary of my competitive Hearthstone ventures.
All right, so we're going to start with the first class. We're going to organize this in terms of class and neutrals. So the first class we're going to start with is the Druid class. So we're going to start with the Enchanted Raven, a 1 mana for 2/2, and it's also a beast. I think this card is pretty good. What do you guys think about that?
Yeah, and at first glance, it's pretty damn strong. 1 mana, 2/2. It's already like overstated for its cost. It's a beast. but it does belong in Druid. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it really only fits the Beast Druid aggressive archetype. I've played around with it before. It's decent. It's not OP or anything. It's good. Nothing much to say about it. Standard one drop, that's good. Later on, it's just a whatever.
Yeah, it's a pretty vanilla minion. So at the time of this recording, only one wing has been released. So we haven't seen like all the Beast Druid tools come together from this expansion. And the other one being like the card that's really been overhyped this expansion is the Menagerie Warden, which we'll be going over later. But once that card comes into set, I expect Beast Druid to become a lot stronger. This card might not look like a lot, but it provides a really solid foundation for Beast Druid to go off of. The most obvious combo being this turn 1 Enchanted Raven, turn 2 Mark of Yashiraj, which gives you a 2-mana 4/4, which doesn't miss on turn 2, which is pretty insane.
And like, you get a card out of it, it's pretty damn good.
Yeah, not killing it. And this being a beast in the late game gives you like some semblance of value for if you top deck Mark of Yashiraj, if you top deck Menagerie Warden, those cards aren't dead, and it's just pretty solid all around.
Yeah.
Not that much to say about it.
It's really good at taking the early game, which is so damn important for a deck like Beast Druid, which Druid just generally doesn't come back from behind.
Yeah, gives them something to do.
Exactly.
Yeah, in an early game.
Take the board.
Yeah, something that you need. Like, other than Living Roots, at least you have another solid one drop minion.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. Please no more aggro druids.
Gives you that one drop consistency. Yeah. It allows you to hit it like that much more.
Like it's like Zombie Chow, but you know.
But this is better. It doesn't heal.
No, it's missing one like health stat. So
yeah, true.
In terms of board presence, just a little.
Just a little bit.
Just a little.
Yeah,
you know?
But there's a lot of synergy involved.
It's a beast. It ain't no zombie.
Yeah.
That's for sure.
In Arena, I'd say this card is like slightly worse than Zombie Chow because of that one health, but it's still going to be a pretty decent.
I'd say it's a lot worse.
It's a lot worse, but it still contests 3/2s and it doesn't die to hero power, so it's not that bad.
Yeah. So do you want to introduce the next card that we're going to talk about?
Yeah, so the next card we're talking about is what we were just discussing, the Menagerie Warden, and this card at first glance seems absolutely insane. I actually thought this was a Hunter card when I first looked at it. I was like, I know it was absolutely like just I could not comprehend the power of this card when I looked at it. Coin High Main into this, but okay, it's actually a Druid card. Calm down, everybody. All right, so obvious combo that you can see from this one is that you can play Stranglethorn Tiger on turn 5 and then play the Menagerie Warden. And that seems like a pretty good combo if you ask me, but I think like this card isn't as insane as people think it is. It's really good. Like, don't get me wrong.
I agree with you.
I agree with you.
But it's just a solid card which will give Beast Druid a foundation to start becoming a viable deck archetype.
I'm actually going to say that this is going to change what the current Beast Druid, how it performs. Because the current Beast Druid is fully, it's very aggressive. Yeah. This gives it the more late game sustain that turns him into more of a mid-range deck.
Yeah, mid-range,
deck.
Yeah.
It's sort of like Call of the Wild for Hunter is.
No, not really.
Or High Main.
It's just, it's a strong, it's a big value card. It's a value card for a tempo-based deck.
Yeah, it allows them to sustain the late game and also just gives massive value in tempo.
That's right.
Yeah. Which is what Call of the
But that being said, like it's dependent on setting up the board for it. So kind of like Princess Huhuran, which is kind of like nuts, 5-mana, 6/5, activated Death Rattle. It doesn't do all that much if you don't have a target for it. It's just overstated for its cost, but you know, can just get removed for a 5-drop. You kind of want something sticky or something that does something immediately, like a Kodo or a Tiger, you know?
I'm not super knowledgeable about Beast Druid, but I don't believe they ran Stranglethorn Tiger.
They do.
But this card will incentivize Beast Druids to run cards more like Stranglethorn Tiger.
Yeah, more
cards,
like, yeah.
Individual minions that are really good to be copied.
Yeah.
Or like have the Faceless Manipulator effect on the Stranglethorn Tiger.
You know the Beast?
Well, I don't think you want to give him 2/3/3s, do you?
Yeah. Oh no, getting another 9/7.
It's another 9/7.
Yeah,
good. Yeah, 2 9/7s. You don't want 2 9/7s.
You know what's even better?
Yeah,
Corehound.
Yeah, man.
But that Corehound's a 7-drop.
Yeah, it's a 7-drop.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, the beast is a 6-drop.
It's kind of make you sustain.
Yeah.
Oh man, you have two Corehounds and you Savage Roar.
Yeah. If I actually do see kind of like a
that doesn't sound like a viable card.
Yeah.
It sounds pretty dope though.
Yeah.
True.
That being said, I think this card is okay. It's not like
I would definitely.
It's not great, but it's all right.
I would rate this in the top 3 cards in my like for the entire.
That's
expansion,
a bold
actually.
Statement.
That's a very very bold statement.
I would definitely rate top 3. Maybe not the first one, but definitely top 3.
I'd say it's top 4.
All right. Let's just agree to disagree.
Sure thing. All right. Now we're looking at the Druid Portal card that they got this set. Six mana, Moonglade Portal. Restore six health, summon a random six cost minion. Seems like a...
Very interesting card.
Yeah.
It's a very...
That's a very PC way of saying it.
Yeah. I think out of all the portals, this is one of the better portals.
No, this is definitely not one of the better portals.
It's not?
I think it's one of the better portals.
Yeah, it's one of the better portals.
Here's why. Because you're paying six mana to... Okay, you restore six health, which for the most part isn't very... it doesn't do anything. And you get a six drop, which in general, throughout Hearthstone's history, and even now, is the better mana slot for good random six drop minions. If that makes sense. Because you can hit Sylvanas or Cairn or...
When you're just saying that this card isn't one of the better portals in the set.
Okay, hold on.
Six drop is a good mana cost for
a lot of minions like Sylvanas and Cairn. Yeah. And Emperor Thoris. There's a lot of good minions.
It is the same mana cost. Yeah. Like six. Wait. Yes. For a six cost minion. Yeah. And you get six additional
health.
Healing.
But you restore six health.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good effect.
It's almost you need to set up for that six health to be relevant. Otherwise, you're doing nothing. You're playing six mana for a random ash six drop.
Yeah.
For the irrelevant. I don't know.
No. But what's great about the Moonglade Portal is that it's also a spell, so that feeds Yogg.
And the second thing about it is
I think you're looking at it from a perspective where you think that you can only cast Moonglade Portal on yourself.
No, of course not. You can hit like an Ancient of War. It'd be pretty dope.
And you can Moonglade Portal that. And that's when it's actually pretty crazy.
But that's when it's there.
Restoring six health and summoning random six cost minion. Summoning random six cost, specifically six cost minions, is really good. A lot better than five or seven.
Think of it this way.
All right.
You have nothing on board.
Okay.
Your opponent's beating you down. You have this Moonglade Portal. Okay, hold on. Think of it this way. You're building a deck, and you put in all these good cards that do things. You know, they synergize with each other. They have a purpose. Then you have Moonglade Portal.
And I can't see this card as bad just by the virtue of Shield Maiden being a thing and being one of the best cards ever released for the Warrior class. It doesn't give you armor, so it doesn't allow you to go over the health cap, and doesn't synergize with Shield Slash. But it's a spell, which is its own thing with Yogg, and it also restores six health to a minion or yourself, which has a lot of utility. So I would rate this card.
All right, fine. You would put this is like a one or two up.
I actually argue that this card might see more play in Constructed than Firelands Portal, even though I would rate Firelands Portal a better card.
From a pure value point of view, this card
has more applications than
Constructed. Yeah, it's more applications, more flexible. Constructed.
So I would rate this card as pretty good, as like one of the better cards of the set. I wouldn't rate it. It would be amazing, but it's
one of the better cards. But is it good?
I would say this is a card that I would definitely put in a Yogg.
It's playable.
It's playable. I wouldn't say it's good. I would not see it being played.
All right, well, I guess we'll see in a few.
We'll see in a couple weeks.
Yeah, watch this thing get you Volcanic Drakes, man. Fuck this card.
Well, you're the guy who doesn't play Malkrok because he gets curse play 100.
I play Malkrok now. All right. He's kind to me.
All right. You respect it
He's
now.
He's gone over the hump.
Yeah, you respect
of
it
his,
now.
I understand the probability. You may get bad luck sometimes. It's just part of it.
I've seen this guy get five curse blades in a row. It's like, bullshit. Literally five curse blades in a row after playing Malkrok five games in a row, so.
Oh, I called it.
He has a vendetta against cards like this, so don't blame him if he gets
it. No, honestly, okay, no, we've already gone through this, I know. It's okay. It's an okay card. It's not great.
I would definitely put in Yogg Druid.
Once I saw this was Yogg Druid.
Yeah, this is definitely a Yogg Druid card.
Yeah, straight up.
Minimum a one of.
Look, okay, this is fucking...
Okay. It's just one card.
I mean, good as a priest card, but not a fucking druid card. Sorry, I'm mad. This card sucks.
All right, let's move on.
All right.
It's the next one.
Okay, now we're going to get started with the Hunter cards. The first card that we're coming up with is a Cat Trick. It's a new Hunter Secret. It's a cat in the hat. How cute. After your opponent casts a spell, you get a Jungle Panther, 4/2 Panther with Stealth. I like it. I like the idea of it, but I think it's pretty bad. It's just not good. It's too conditional upon your opponent fulfilling a requirement that doesn't happen all the time. Especially against aggressive decks, this secret basically just kind of spends a card from your hand, does nothing, and lays around, and your opponents are going to probably guess that it's this if it's not a freezing trap or like an explosive trap, and they just kind of not play into it ever until it doesn't matter anymore.
Yeah, I have to agree with you. All it really does, in terms of impacting the current metagame, is increase the secret diversity and the spell diversity, the secret and spell pool for lock and load. and this will allow you to have more, have better miracle turns with the Cloaked Huntress lock and load, which a lot of prominent ladder players have already been experimenting with, where you can play Cloaked Huntress lock and load, and then cast all the secrets that you get, both in your hand and off lock and load, and this will allow you to hit that 5 secret limit more often.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's all. It's such a niche scenario, though.
And all I see for this card is in terms of like I said impacting the metagame is that this card is just not worth the individual card slot, and all it's going to do is give you more possibilities off of lock and load.
Yeah. Well, what I think about this card is like it covers all the things that you can actually play around. Like let's say I think this is a freezing trap, right? But I suddenly use a spell and then suddenly triggers this. It's similar to how Dark Trap works, right? And nobody actually uses that card. But I guess like something like
Cloaked Huntress.
Yeah, Cloaked Huntress. Yeah, maybe it would make this card a little bit more fun.
Wouldn't that be nice?
Yeah, maybe it will make it work, but maybe it won't. But yeah, there's definitely going to be a lot of secrets being played in Hunters in the future meta.
Perhaps. Yeah. I'm going to call it now. I think it's all a gimmick.
All right, so now on to the Cloaked Huntress, as we were just discussing earlier. So when I first saw this card, I actually thought it was like effing crazy. Because it, like, making spells cost zero is a huge deal in Hearthstone. Yeah. So it allows you to pull off some ridiculous turns, especially if that spell involves card draw. And with lock and load, it's pseudo card draw, so you can actually get secrets off of lock and load, as we were talking about earlier. And this basically becomes Mysterious Challenger, like except even crazier, and you don't have to put these crappy cards in your deck because you can just keep cycling the secrets off of lock and load. So even though like that whole idea actually sounds pretty crazy, having a 3-drop, a 3-mana, 3/4 with casting 5 secrets on turn 5, people have already tried this, and in practice, it doesn't seem to work that well. What are your thoughts on that?
I have the opposite view from you. When I saw this card at first, I didn't think it was that great. 3-mana, 3/4 is fantastic, but being a hunter card and not being a beast, it's those are downsides to it. Plus, the secrets costing zero, we already had a card like that from the very beginning called Kirin Tor Mage, which, mage secrets are generally a lot stronger. That being said, they are clunky as all hell, so you would never kind of... play secrets in even a tempo mage without some way to cheat it out through the card called Mad Scientist. Yeah. So with Cloaked Huntress, it doesn't even compare to Mysterious Challenger because it's conditional upon you having secrets in your hand. Mm-hmm. So it has to synergize with cards that are in your hand for it to work. It doesn't thin your deck out like Mysterious Challenger did. And in a deck archetype like Hunter doesn't need to do all these things. It's more about going face.
No, but the difference is with Spell Hunter, you don't need this to be obvious, and having a 3/4 stat line is actually better than a 4/3.
Yeah, but is
the whole goal is to just delay until you get Yogg.
So this is specifically a Yogg control. Yeah, it would kind be a Yogg control. It doesn't belong in the standard midrange Hunter.
No, it doesn't. Not at all. No. But we've already seen it in practice, and the only promising builds I think are actually not the Yogg builds. It's the Secret Keeper builds, where it's not very consistent. But when it goes off, it's pretty crazy because you can basically just play a 1-mana Yeti with the Secret Keeper.
So you're saying it's inconsistent. It's good but generally it's just kind of...
It's a pretty polarizing card. When it works, it's absolutely ridiculous and your opponent can't do anything. But I'd say for the majority of the time, you won't be able to get off those crazy combos.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. All right. Ooh. So you want to introduce the next card?
So the next card is the 2-mana 1/1, the Kindly Grandmother, which I believe it summons a 3/2 Big Bad Wolf as a death rattle. So in my opinion, this is like the next Haunted Creeper.
This is pretty good.
Yeah, this is what we've been waiting for.
Upon first glance, I thought this card is really strong. This is what Hunter needed.
Yeah, this is what
this
they
is
going to
bring Hunter back.
Yeah.
Another 2-drop that has annoying ass death rattles. It's personally, I believe it's not as good as Haunted Creeper, because of its base stat line as it is to begin with. Mm-hmm. A 1/2 is just so difficult to deal with.
Yeah, it makes a huge difference.
Compared to a 1/1. So if they wanted to clear the spiders afterwards, killing the Haunted Creeper first was troublesome. But with this one, you can kind of just ping it off with like most hero powers and then deal with the 3/2 whenever you wished. Not only that, the 3/2, you have to, if you want to activate it, you're going to have to make the trade, but you're going to lose initiative on it. That being said, it is a beast, and the Big Bad Wolf is a beast, and in the current meta, this is pretty good. Mm-hmm. Great 2-drop, slam it down. It does its thing. It trades up, becomes a 3-2, 4-3 stats, 2 mana. Wow.
Yeah, I have to agree with you guys. It's a pretty good card. It does have a different dynamic from Haunted Creeper in the sense that, okay, like Haunted Creeper is actually like people don't want to commit resources to killing it.
Yeah.
Because and like both forms of Haunted Creeper and both the 1/1 spiders, the 1/1 spiders, like they're basically both pretty low impact, but for board control decks, it gives you a lot to work with, like Abusive Sergeant and Houndmaster for the first part of Haunted Creeper.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
With this card, they're not really incentivized to kill it. They don't want to ping and give you a 3-2, and then you Houndmaster that, or you hit, because it doesn't get rid of the beast egg. The reason why people killed Haunted Creeper in the past, like just the first form, even though they gave you more stats and gave you more power on board, is because they don't want to give you the beast energy, specifically beast Hunter. Energy. This they're not incentivized to kill it.
Yeah.
And not yeah. Like this is not even bearing in mind that the 3-2 is bigger than the 1-1.
Mm-hmm.
Before the 2-1-1s is pretty comparable to the 1-2, and they just want to get rid of the beast energy. This is, you're giving them a much larger minion. And what's great about this card is that it already has one attack, so you don't have to activate it. It can already attack it can already attack itself and activate the 3-2 itself.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd say this is a pretty good card. I wouldn't say it's crazy, but it gives Hunter more 2-drop options other than Flame Juggler, Huge Toad, and King's Alec, which they've pretty much been pigeonholed into since the Whispers of the Old Gods expansion.
I'd say it's pretty crazy.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's damn good. It even incentivizes Hukuran Band back into the deck.
Yeah.
So you have more targets to hit with it.
I don't think Hukuran.
It's a strong 5-drop, 6/5.
I don't think you play Hukuran just for this 2-drop.
No.
Not just for this 2-drop. Yeah. It just increases the pool of cards that you can hit with Hukuran.
Hukuran is therefore making it.
I actually thought that card would be played quite a bit just because the stat line, it was just so good. But
it didn't make too much of an impact itself. Yeah. But now it has enough synergy for it to actually see play again.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's going to see play as well as this card a lot.
Generally with Hukuran, you want to see Death Rattles that actually create minions. You don't want to
kind of like Raptor, huh?
You don't want to see like Huge Toad.
Yeah.
You don't want to see.
You don't want Huge Toad, Fiery Bat.
You don't want to see.
It's kind of irrelevant.
The deck looks like it has a lot of Death Rattles, but if you look at Huge Toad and Fiery Bat, they're not actually Death Rattles if you think about it.
But I guess Sylvanas is the only exception. Yeah. Just because it's steel minions, but that's pretty much it though.
So the verdict is pretty good.
Yeah, it's pretty.
Pretty good to crazy.
Pretty good. Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay, so the next class that we're going to review is going to be the Mage. So the first card we're going to talk about is the Babbling Book, a 1-mana 1/1. I actually think this card is awesome. There's just so much synergy, especially when it adds a random mage spell, since all mage spells are actually fairly strong, as we know, under all their secrets, the bird spells that they have. And one thing I really like about this card is that it combos with Brand Bronzebeard.
It does.
Giving you a lot of value.
I don't see this card seeing play in Tempo Mage, though, because it's not impactful enough by itself as a 1-drop, and giving you a random spell is not the best effect specifically for Tempo Mage. With aggro decks and Tempo decks, you want to see consistency in your deck, and this does not give you consistency. This isn't Battlecry, draw a card.
Mm-hmm.
And a 1-mana 1/1 minion that has Battlecry, draw a card, see play, I don't know, but giving you or generating a random spell that might not help your game plan, generating a Catalyst Tome. I guess with Tempo Mage...
I'm going to disagree with you right there, but no, please keep going.
Yeah, okay.
Sorry about that.
With Tempo Mage, you're not going to get the spells you need very often. You might get, Ice Block or something with Tempo Mage, and that's not going to help you with your game plan. I actually see this seeing play and actually helping a lot with Reno Mage or a Control Mage, because even though a 1-mana 1/1 doesn't seem very impactful, it's still a minion that they have to deal with, and with the Mage Hero Power, since Mage doesn't have that, Control Mage doesn't have that many turn 2 plays, coupling it with the Hero Power is going to be, able to take down a 3-2, take down a Huge Toad, take down a King's Alec. Mm-hmm. It's actually still going to be relevant, and giving you that spell is going to be good. Mm-hmm. It synergizes with Brand, as you said earlier, and that Brand is a staple of Reno Mage and Control Mage.
Yeah.
It's just that, at the moment, I don't personally see a viable Reno Mage or Control Mage build yet.
Mm-hmm.
They're just lacking a few tools.
Yeah, a few tools.
But this is definitely one of those tools that Reno Mage was looking for. A 1-drop minion that sort of contests the board and gives you a spell in return. And Reno Mage will be able to make use of that spell and convert value from it.
Yeah, because the Reno Mage is really comparable to before Standard, which is the Grinder Mage.
Yeah.
Where they have Echo, Medivh, and Duplicate, where they get tons of value off the minions I actually play. But now we're getting more kind of spell value. I guess this is what Green No Mage is actually looking for. Since they run one copy of each, this actually allows you to actually set up a brand spawn speed, like you have enough time. Yeah, so I agree with you, it doesn't fit really into a tempo mage deck, but more of a control-based oriented type of deck.
Since you're skipping turn one, like the vast majority of the time is tempo mage, you're never unhappy to see this in your opening hand.
Yeah, exactly.
Playing it as a body and getting a random spell.
Yeah, even having hero power, that's already one turn too wasted, right?
And so late game, already pretty good. There's a really high chance of you getting a relevant spell from this.
Yeah.
Whether it be Cabalus, Tome, or Effigy, or whatever, it's still...
Yeah, I love those cards. I love cards that give value.
It's an interesting card, but unfortunately I don't see it seeing play in either for Freeze Mage, like in either of the current two popular mage archetypes, which is Freeze Mage for obvious reasons and Tempo Mage because it's not consistent enough.
I'm going to see it as a 2-up in all Tempo Mage decks.
All right.
Mage really lacks early game. That's its biggest problem. You have to start with Mana Worm, otherwise you're just not taking the board. So, this gives you two more 1-drops, and this the body's not that great, but it's still a 1-drop, 1-1. It's like Web Spinner. Web Spinner was in every Hunter deck because it was a 1-1 beast, a turn 1 play. It gave you more like fuel afterwards. This does exactly that. It's a battle cry too.
The difference with Hunter and Mage is it doesn't have the beast archetype going for it though.
Like, no, but it's got a lot of it has a spell thing going for it. All spells synergize with Sorcerer's Apprentice, which is an and Flame Waker, which is in every Temple Mage deck.
It synergizes with Flame Waker, but it doesn't synergize with Sorcerer's Apprentice in the late
game. It does.
It doesn't because you're
not late game. We're not talking late game.
Yeah, because
it's going to give you additional fuel to use as a Tempo Mage to fuel that Flame Waker Sorcerer's Apprentice bullshit.
Yeah, but
excuse my language. It's just going to give more tools to the deck.
The difference with Web Spinner and this is because Web Spinner is played as an early game drop.
This is also
played as an early game play.
This is also an early game play. That's the idea.
But top decking Web Spinner in the late game is not bad. Top decking this, though, in the late game, if you're Tempo Mage, if you get to that point, you're already going to lose.
And you might not. You might get the fireball you need to kill your opponent.
And playing is that consistent enough, though?
It's not, but neither is Web Spinner.
Yeah, but Web Spinner has the use of Houndmaster and Kill Command, and those are two staple cards.
The idea is it's a 1-drop. 1-drops are very easy to fit.
1-mana 1-1s for aggro decks is not impactful enough, period. So
it gives you a spell. That's the idea.
You're not
if it was a 1-mana 1-1, that's garbage. But this battle card gives you a mage spell. A mage spell. How many mage spells are burn spells? A lot. How many of them are secret spells?
The majority of them are not burn spells, actually.
Not the majority, but you get
the vast majority of them.
You have a decent. We don't have like a chart of probabilities here, but look.
I do. As in, I know them off the top of my head. Most spells are not.
What a prodigy!
Whoa, what a prodigy!
Wow, King of Kimchi.
Okay,
but real.
So, how many burn spells do you have? You have Frostbolt.
You have Fireball. You have Dragon's Breath. You have Frostbolt. You have Forgotten Torch. You have that Forbidden Flame.
Forbidden Flame got burn damage.
Pyroblast.
Yeah, you have that's 4 burn.
You got Arcane Blast.
The portal.
You have Arcane Blast. You have Arcane Missiles. You have
Arcane Blast isn't burn spell either. It doesn't go face.
It's not a face burn spell, but it's removal.
Burn spell.
Getting a removal is damn important.
Yeah, but
look, it just gives you fuel. It's a 1-mana 1-1. It gives you fuel. It replaces itself.
I just feel like the synergy just
it's
isn't
a tempo
there.
Card. It's not a control card. It's a tempo card. There you go.
Yeah. No, well, what? I don't know.
It has flexibility.
I'm viewing this differently from you are.
You're not happy playing this on turn one.
Yes, you are.
No,
if you don't have a mana worm, that sucks. But at least you have a babbling book.
Right.
And you get a spell from it. Hell, it's a Frostbolt. You didn't have a Frostbolt turn 2, but now you do.
Okay.
You Frostbolt their thing, they play turn 1.
If it was discovered.
Yeah, if it was discovered, that's what I was going to say. If it wasn't discovered,
then it would be overpoweredly good. It'd be stupidly good, but it's a battle cry. They were thinking.
And when you get.
Listen.
When you get Ice Block off of it, you're just going to be really sad. Or you get any spell that's just.
That's a fringe scenario. For the most part, you'll get something decent.
Yeah.
Turn one, you don't have Mana Worm. Right. You play Babbling Book. Their turn one, they play Tunnel Charge. You got a Frostbolt.
We're gonna move on.
You're gonna kill them. You push another
damage.
It's a 1-mana
1-1.
It's a good 1-1.
It's just a 1-mana 1-1. We're moving on. All right. So the next card we're talking about is the Firelands Portal. And the Firelands Portal is the card that a lot of famous like arena streamers like Crypt have been complaining about because not only is it drastically overpowered for its mana cost in arena, it's also a common card, so you're gonna be seeing it very often, and it's in the most recent expansion, so it also has the expansion bonus.
So it's an amazing arena card, but let's talk about Constructed.
Yeah.
Look at this piece of crap.
The thing is, I don't see,
when I looked at this card, I thought it would be okay for Reno Mage.
Yeah.
But then I played Reno Mage myself, I couldn't fit this card in.
Think about it, it's too slow to deal five damage.
And
the 5-drop you get?
Yeah.
It's not going to guarantee anything good.
Yeah, not getting anything good, because the 5-drops, like, the the kind
I think
of minions
that control mage.
I don't.
It's weird.
Tempo.
No, no, because there's
too
so
slow.
Many. There's too slow. There's so many other cards
Here's
that you can play. That's
the best.
Better than this
the
card.
Best analogy being Flame Strike. Yeah. This does not compete with Flame Strike.
Yeah, this does not compete with Flame Strike. Would you run Flame Strike or this card?
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah.
But it does go face. That's
yeah,
cool.
Yeah, it does go face. Yeah, that's the advantage.
Reach, a little bit of, you know. Yeah.
You don't want to be using this to go face. Like, it's
you
better
don't.
To be
Yeah, to control, right?
But
it's too slow to actually control.
In terms of utility, yes.
Yeah.
Like, essentially, like, the Forgotten Torch is a lot better than this.
I see this having a possibility of being played. And not a good chance.
I don't see it having a good chance either. It could be... You know, people will test it, of course.
Yeah. I think it's meant to be, like,
it
a
is
strong
meant to be,
arena card.
Which Mage obviously needs more of.
Yeah. Yeah, right, it's a little... This card's a little awkward to use.
This card has also been over, like spoken about. A lot of people have been complaining about it.
Yeah. In what way?
As in the fact that, like, it's a ridiculous arena card, and it should be switched to a rare or an epic.
Just because
people don't want to see it that much in arena.
True. I probably wouldn't want to see this in arena.
Just by the virtue of that, though, which is why I think there's, like, a fringe chance that it'll see playing constructed, just because it's so overpowered in arena.
Yeah.
It has to translate into constructed somehow, right?
The only way I'm going to see this being played in constructed is if you built, like, a Reno deck that oriented around, like, Yogg-Saron.
Yogg-Saron
does run flame lance. Like, some people does run the flame lance to remove, like, pretty big minions. You can essentially do this with it too and generate, like, a 5-drop and then fuel Yogg at the same time. But you can probably figure out, like, a certain deck list to actually include this card. Like, it's not that bad, but I think it's a little bit below average in construction.
I think it's too situational to be included in deck. Yeah. It will be generated by Cabalist's Tome and Babbling Book and other real content
stuff.
But you're not gonna main deck it.
Too situational in the sense that, like, you're not gonna make it to turn 7 to play it. Because it's pretty it's pretty versatile, if you ask me.
It'll see play.
It's 5 damage.
It'll be generated. It won't be included.
Yeah. Because since there's, like, the meta is pretty fast, like, there's a lot of aggressive decks, by the time I hit turn 7, I'd rather use a Flame Strike than this card.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think of that, like, that the argument you just used about it not be, only being generated and only being not being included is, like, that's what I thought about the Hunter card we were discussing, the Cat Trick. But this card is so much better than the Cat Trick.
Yeah.
So then, like...
It's a different deck,
the
too.
The fact
it's,
that we're
it's a different deck.
Those, just,
yeah.
Something seems off here.
It does seem off, like... There definitely needs to be more testing, so...
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, so the last card, Medivh's Valet. 2 mana, 2/3, deals 3 damage, conditional upon you having a secret.
This card is crazy.
This card is crazy.
This card is freaking crazy, and it will single-handedly enable Mage secret decks.
Yeah.
And, but the bad thing about this deck, the bad thing about this card, though, as in I don't see it, like, creating an aggressive tempo secret deck, but I see it as, like, a really, really good one-off in, like, Reno Mage, or, like, it might be so good that you run it as a 2-of, because if you have Icebox up, this is just basically 2 mana, it's like a 2 mana fire elemental, that's crazy, that's absolutely crazy, and it's good late game, too, because it's basically a Frostball on a body.
Yeah.
For 2 mana.
Yeah.
Which means you'll almost always be able to curve this up, which is just absolutely ridiculous. It's 100% active with Ice Block.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
However, it's not a tempo card.
It's not a tempo card.
Yeah, it's not a tempo card.
There's a condition to it.
Because
you
can't play a secret till turn 3 in, like, in standard. And this is a 2-drop, so.
Yeah.
This is an interesting card.
I guess
in
Wild is pretty good.
Yeah, in Wild. Wild is just absolutely absurd.
Insane.
Yeah.
You coin Mad Scientist, and then you play. You trade it in and play.
And then you steamroll your opponent, and then you rage quit.
Yeah.
Damn. Mm-hmm. That being said, my prediction on this card is it's not going to see play. It's...
The 3 cards we just talked about were sort of, like, hinging on finding a place in Reno Mage.
Yeah.
And then if you add all 3 cards of these together, they might actually see play.
Yeah,
they might actually make
Reno
Mage or Grinder Mage viable.
Maybe,
like,
in a few days.
Like,
maybe for
this,
weeks,
I can actually see
know.
It in Reno Mage because it does help you control the board and you will play Ice Block.
And it's not bad as a 2-drop, as a River Crocolis to contest the
Absolutely.
Board.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So it definitely has... applications in Reno Mage.
The only issue I find with it is it's not a spell, it's a minion, so the 3 damage doesn't synergize with things like Antonitis.
Reno Mage isn't looking for a spell
power synergy.
It's just the Antonitis synergy.
Reno Mage isn't even a good deck, though. I don't know why you're talking about
it
so much.
Might be a good deck with this, though. I've seen Grinder Mage in action and it's done work at High Legend. But if you watch like the biggest Reno Mage enthusiast, probably Strifegrow, and he, like, loves playing Grinder Mage, and he does pretty well with it at High Legend. I've lost a few times to him, and he's been playing with worst builds without Medivh's Valet, without Babbling Book, without the Firelands Portal, and with these three cards, I could see it actually making a comeback. Or not a comeback. Really just becoming a deck in general.
Sure.
Yeah.
I don't think so.
All right.
Grinder Mage died with a standard rotation. Yeah. That's what I feel.
I don't know, maybe those will bring it back.
Yeah, maybe those, these cards.
Oh, maybe.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah. We'll see. We'll see soon enough. We'll see.
They need to reprint and duplicate.
Yeah. You start.
All right. So we're going to the Paladin cards. So the first card we're going to review is the 6-mana 4/4 Ivory Knight. So each discover a spell. Is it a spell?
Yes.
Yeah. And it restores whatever its mana cost is.
To your hero, yeah.
Yeah, to your hero.
Yep.
What do you think about this card? I thought this card was pretty good, just because it does provide you the utility and flexibility of what you need.
I think it's pretty bad.
Stat-wise, it's pretty bad.
Stat-wise, it's bad. And if you consider its effects, discovering a spell is good. Mm-hmm. I like that. But the stats, 6 mana 4/4, it's very underwhelming. Not only that, the Paladin cards, the only ones that will heal a significant amount of health are Avenging Wrath, Lay on Hands, and that Murloc one. Which you're never going to pick unless you have Murlocs in your deck. What kind of Murloc deck will run this? Not the, whoa.
You can still...
I just thought of something! You can run Murloc Paladin.
Yeah.
The combo.
You know, you can
with
still
this
pick...
this card.
You know, you can still run this in a control deck and still pick the 10-drop spell over Secrets.
Just
even
to get,
if you have
just
no
health.
Yeah,
just get
exactly.
health.
Yeah, just get health.
And if you think about it, that's better than Healbot.
Yeah. It's like a lot of flexibility.
You're
like,
paying one more mana for two more health and plus one in stats. Mm-hmm. And it has flexibility in discovering new spell. If you choose to have you pick the Murloc, like the ten spell, you're not getting a spell. Like you're not getting a spell.
You're
but you have
health.
The option of getting the spell. Yeah. If you get Lay on Hands off of this, it's freaking crazy.
And even Avenging Wrath,
you get the
nuts.
8 health, and you get the 8 health from the Lay on Hands. So that's sick. That's a 16 health swing, so that's pretty crazy. The reason why I don't think this card is good, even though it looks good on paper, is that like Paladin doesn't need any more healing.
Yeah,
it already has amazing healing options in the form of forbidden healing.
Yeah, but here's the upside of it: it gives you a spell, so it kind of replaces itself. You get more utility. You get to discover it. Discovering is good. You get three chances. Yeah. The issue is most of the Paladin spells are kind of trash.
If you're discovering, the likelihood of getting all three secrets is not that high. And if you think about it this way, Healbot was considered a bad card. Most people who reviewed it back in GVZ thought it was absolute garbage.
Really?
It turned out to be an amazing card.
I thought it was good just by looking at it.
A lot of people thought
it was good. No.
Why are you so good at predicting
cards?
No.
He's never going to see
play. It got really good when Bran started to come out.
Yeah.
It was even better before that.
Yeah.
But then the thing with Ivory Knight is it's actually, if you think about it, it's better than Healbot because you're paying one, it has +1/+1 in stats, which is not too relevant because all you're looking for it is from a heal, but the discover a spell mechanic is so flexible and so versatile,
and
you can get heal up to 10 with this and get like an impactful spell to deal
with.
That's
if you can choose that card.
Yeah, like you don't necessarily need the healing either. You can just look for a spell that you need, like quality or even consecrate.
So what's great,
like,
Healbot is completely dead in control matchups, and this can still discover you
a
relevant spell.
So this has utility.
Yeah.
And it has healing. And it has a body, a decent one.
I definitely think this is a good card. I just don't know if this will see constructed play.
Paladin is not in a good spot right now.
I'm actually seeing it being played right now.
Is it doing work?
It's not really.
Yes. Yeah. I like the design of this card though. It's nice.
I like it. It might give mid range Paladin a few more options.
What? No, definitely
options.
Not.
Not mid range. I can see people building like a Reno.
Because mid range, a lot of people have experimenting with mid range.
This is a good Reno card.
Yeah, this is a good Reno card. You play Bran with this card, you get double the amount of spells that you can get for utility
and double the healing.
And double the healing, exactly.
Yeah.
So it's like a anti Killbot 2.0.
Mid-range Nezhothedin is actually a pretty, like, it's pretty relevant, though.
Yeah, it is.
It's like,
yeah,
it's basically just a faster version of Nezhoth.
Relevant,
Paladin.
Maybe, but it's not really a good deck.
Yeah.
It's very draw-dependent.
Yeah.
Well, it's like all decks.
Yeah,
true,
well,
true,
some
true,
some
true.
Decks are a little more consistent than that, especially the Temple Mage with the Babbling Book.
Played it off cool. Anyway, so we're moving on to the Nightbane Templar, and I think this card is freaking crazy. It's Muster for Dragons, basically.
Yeah, it's Muster for Dragons.
If you think about it, like, I don't know how people ever thought Muster for Battle was, like, that good, because they compared it with Razor Fen Hunter, which is an absolutely terrible card. It's a 3-mana, 2-3, 1-1. Must for Battle is 3 1-1s. So you're basically you're sacrificing a at the 2-3. You're splitting up the 2-3 into 2 1-1s. Is that a worthwhile trade for the 2 1-1s and the 1-4 weapon? Apparently, it was one of the best cards of GVG. Mm-hmm. So how good is this card gonna be? That's the question. Is it better than the Blackwing Technician?
Blackwing Technician, yes. Whoa.
No, you can't say that.
Actually, no, I can say yes. Because it's better than a single 3-5 body. The 2 1-1s are very relevant for
it's not paired, but yeah, you just the thing you can do certain things with the 1-1, like you manipulate them, you can use abusive sergeants on them. Yeah,
it's like
pretty
keeper
good.
Keeper of Voldemort.
Yeah,
you might even 3-drop too.
You might even see Night Juggler coming back because of this.
Because
card
just
too. Yeah, just because it's similar, just so similar to
Muster for Dragons.
The main issue is it's
Dragon
it's
Paladin.
It's a build around card. You need dragons in this deck.
Oh my God, mid range. Paladin's coming.
I'm not sure.
Dragon Paladin, like Dragon Warrior.
Dragon Paladin might be relevant before BRM gets rotated because Blackwing Corruptor and all those dragons and cards are still in the game.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
And just because of this card, we'll be able to carry the 3-drop. We'll be able to carry the 3-drop slot.
Mm-hmm.
And better than Blackwing Technician.
It's really good at taking the board.
The problem is Dragon Paladin going to be better than Dragon Warrior, which is the premier dragon deck right now?
Dragon, like, it's a lot slower.
Yeah.
Yeah. They don't really have the Alexstrasza champion, but they do get the consort.
Yeah, the consort can allow for some crazy stuff.
For, like, control. You want Yzera to come out early, right?
Consort also seems like an objectively just good card, but it just never worked out in practice. Yeah. Because if you think about the possible cons, what are you going to do, like... turn 5 Consort and like Yzera.
Yeah, I get
turn 7. Like, it's like it's just not in practice, it just doesn't work out that well.
I believe it's really it allows for power turns. Like, you play the Consort,
power turns,
so you can do like the Bran, the Azure Drake. The next
a lot
turn.
Of people predicted that, like, in Blackrock Mountain, that Dragon Paladin, like, the only dragon viable dragon deck would be Paladin solely because of Dragon Consort. Like, if there's gonna be a dragon deck, it's gonna be Paladin.
People have tried it out, but
it turned
really
out being
just
garbage.
Yeah, I tried it out so many times. Yeah, it's really hard to work.
That was during a different meta game.
Yeah,
it was.
So, but this is better than Muster, right?
No, I wouldn't say it's better than Muster.
No, I wouldn't say better.
Muster
than
for battle was better because it gave you initiative with the weapon.
Yeah, the Life's Justice made it a huge
but
difference.
But the bodies are way better here because instead of gaining one of the 1-1s, you're getting a 2-3, which is pretty relevant.
No, not okay. It's good. It's good.
But
you
can't
get it wrong. But it does not replace that 1-1 weapon.
Yeah,
the 1-4 weapon.
It's instant.
The instant one damage. You can't say it's objectively worse though, right? I'd say this is a way better slow card. If you're just hitting face with a weapon, this is a way better card.
Yes, of course.
Yeah, of course.
So then,
course.
But the weapon contests the board.
The weapon can, like I said, the weapon contests the board. Is it better than the 3-mana 2-3 in like all scenarios? I don't think so.
No.
I still think this is a pretty good card. Just
it's a good
it
card.
Resembles
yeah.
Muster for Battle so much, and it scares everybody. It gives everyone PTSD. So,
but herein lays the problem where Paladin is still missing the good 2-drop.
Yeah, the 2-drop, the mini bot that will never be replaced.
Yeah, that would never be replaced. That's too strong.
Yep.
Yeah.
So
they tried doing something with the 1-mana 2-1.
One mana 2-1.
They tried doing something with that, but right now it's not even that good.
Basically, if Dragon Paladin is good, this card will see play. If not, it won't.
Yeah.
Simple as that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
True.
And the last Paladin card that we're going to be talking about is going to be the Silver Moon Portal. And just straight off the bat, I think this card is bad.
This card is garbage.
Same.
It just does not impact the board enough for 4 mana, and a 2-drop is not relevant.
Would you play this over?
Blessing of Kings, because you're basically just point of Blessing of Kings is that it has charge if you have a minion.
Yeah.
And this does not have. You're basically just cutting out half of the minion and not giving the two of the stats charge.
You're summoning a random 2-drop.
Yeah, the 2-drop could screw you over by summoning
Doomsayer.
Yeah,
Doomsayer.
Yeah. So this card is just not impactful.
It's just it's bad.
I don't want another Pilot Shredder like that.
Yeah. Except this is like obviously way worse. Yeah. Than
would you say this is the worst portal of them all?
Because
I would say it's the worst portal.
Yeah.
You think about the portal. We there's Maelstrom Portal, which is the Shaman. Yeah, that's better than this. Moonglade's better than this.
It's probably the
5-mana armor
one.
Card is better than this.
Oh, that's beautiful.
And the 7-mana and Firelands Portal, which we talked about earlier, is better than this. So this is. For like unequivocally the worst card.
It's just a bad card in general. It's not even good.
Okay, so moving on. So we're going to move on to the priest class. So the first card is going to be the Onyx Bishop, a 5-mana for 3/4, which has a reincarnate effect, which summons a friendly minion that's been died this turn.
Died this game.
Died this game. That's it, right? That's this game. This game.
This card is really good, but unfortunately, it's in the priest class, which automatically relegates it to not being played.
You know, I love priest, but I'm pretty disappointed looking at this card.
This card is good though.
It's very balanced. It is good.
And it's balanced. It doesn't seem overpowered, but it's like a good card, and it helps. Like priest, like it synergizes with like the number one priest minion, which is like the number one priest minion, which is
injured blade master.
Yeah, that's the kind of the synergy. Like maybe you want to Arcanine back just for the circle of
healing
combo.
Be crazy. There's so many minions you get off of this. Good.
Yeah, but there's like a lot of planning you really need to do. Like you don't really want a Northshire dying and then having a injured blade master also dying, and you have to take that 50-50 chance with this Onyx Bishop. And that's the problem with reincarnate too.
It's not resurrect actually.
Oh, resurrect. Right.
Yeah, again, the problem with this card is that it's in priest, so yeah.
Yeah, what priest really needed was a stronger early game.
It needs mini bot and mustard for battle, really.
Yeah, and then there would be the new paladin.
But they would never give it to them.
Yeah, unfortunately. Yeah, never give it to them. Yeah, so, good card, bad class.
Yeah, bad class.
There we go.
Not much to say about it. Priest of the Feast.
Priest of the Feast.
Yeah, I don't know how I feel about
it. I like the stats.
It's
4 mana 3/6 is optimal for a 4-drop.
It's really good.
I think it's better than a 4-5. But the problem is the effect isn't too relevant, and again, it's in the priest class, which is just gives it like -50% in score.
There's actually the other the C'Thun synergy card. It's also 4 mana 3/6, and it wasn't even that good because it didn't affect the board, kind of like this.
Yeah, it doesn't affect the board. It gives you the healing. Now, if you think about what are the spells that the priests use, like the
power shield, slash shield, circle of healing. Yeah. Like honestly, this is really
But the restoring 3 health to your face is not like extremely relevant. If it was like a targeted 3 health heal every time you use a spell,
that would be crazy.
It'd be ridiculous because with like Arcanine.
Oh, restore a random like minion.
You can pull off some like ridiculous turns, but the problem with this card is that it restores health to your hero. Only, and
it doesn't affect the board.
And that doesn't affect the board, so I don't see it in play.
Since this card was released, I actually tried this card out, rather than some other 4-drop. But this card is... I feel like it's okay in certain combo decks because it does allow you to sustain yourself and prolong the game. But then one really unique card that synergizes really well with this card is Shadow Form. Because it does get rid of the healing.
Well, that's true.
It's really specific.
Tournament Medic Senior.
Yeah. But this is like a little better just because it can.
It has a way better stat line.
Yeah, stat line.
But
it's
synergized with spells, not your hero power.
Yeah,
so
but
it's
it's not like you can't have both.
Yeah.
That's why.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can have both like the Tournament Medic and the Priest of the Feast, and then you can just heal tons when you have Shadow Form.
Tournament Medic saw play in the Kibler Shadow Priest like hero power build with like the Coda Rider and like a bunch of other hero power synergy cards, and then that was like not that bad actually.
But it wasn't really a great deck.
It was fun. It worked, and it sort of worked, and it was like okay when you drew Reno for turn 6.
Yep.
Yeah. So I don't know. I don't see it. This card will obviously not see play.
I think it's
not that bad by the virtue of the stat line, and I don't know how to gauge its effect. Really, it's not that good.
I'd like to compare this to Holy Champion. Holy Champion has one less health, which is significant, but
Holy Champion's effect is relevant for the board though.
That's exactly.
Yeah, and it makes it a threatening minion. It actually makes it like the OTK minion.
It's also a very strong minion if it's not dealt with.
But the problem is again the effect is not. It doesn't really do anything.
Yeah. Not too much. So we already have a heal in general too.
That was a bad card.
Yeah.
So the next card we're talking about is Purify, which is this card is fucking amazing. This card is the best card of the set.
Yeah.
Number one.
It really got the community talking.
About it. Yeah, Ben Brode.
I watch a lot of videos about it.
Ben Brode had to do a damage control video.
He made an apology about it. About making a card.
Yeah.
Okay.
Removed it from Arena.
Instead of simply just changing it a little bit.
To be fair, I actually don't think this card is absolutely terrible. If they release more like cards like Eerie Statue and Ancient Watcher, it's not that bad.
Yeah, but you said it's true.
If.
However,
but this card sets like a precedent so that like Blizzard can build off of that, so they can make this card not terrible. The problem is a lot of the other self silence cards rotated out, most notably the 4 mana 3/5 from Nexus.
The Wailing Soul?
Yeah, the Wailing Soul.
Yeah.
That was the thing that enabled Silence Druid, which had like saw a little bit of play.
Oh, that was pretty fun, yeah.
Yeah, but this specifically lets you draw like cycle off of it and activate an Ancient Watcher or an Eerie Statue. So
the big there are like a few main offenders with this card. first off, it's mana cost. Yeah. It's too expensive for what it is.
I think if it was silence any minion, it might see play.
Then it would be, it would be really strong.
Yeah. But if it's like friendly minion, I really want it to be one cost.
It's actually not absolutely garbage, like I said. But
it's not.
If it were one mana, it would still not be a lot as good of people's, as Powered Shield. Sorry for talking over you.
No, a lot of people's arguments were like, they're basically complaining that this card, you're paying two mana to get a detrimental effect. The effect, you're not going to be playing this card to get the detrimental effect. Like, you're not going to play this in like a tempo priest.
Yeah, you
you're
going to
play this
around
in a deck where you have minions that you want to be silenced.
Like Ancient Watcher, Eerie Statue, etc.
But those are the only, those are pretty much the only cards that, like, there's like Ogre Brute that's not in the
current, it's no
that,
there,
that,
yeah.
that's not in the current rotation. There's like, yeah, they basically, Blizzard needs to print more cards like that, and they need to print more of those silence effects, self-silence effects, and then the deck might be viable.
We want to see people playing the Beast.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if a 6-mana 9/7 vanilla would even see play. So that's
Really?
Yeah.
Hey, BGH is gone.
It's better than
BGH is gone, but yeah, it is better than, it just, it's not a dragon.
Oh.
Yeah.
It's a Beast, though.
It's a Beast.
It is a Beast.
Yeah,
it's better than Beast.
Menagerie Monitoring on it. Damn, two of the Beasts. Then you silence.
And this is a priest card though, so I don't know how you're gonna play Menagerie Warden and priest.
You're not. Unless you thought steal it, then you have beast.
That's a different story.
So TLDR, this best card of the set.
Also, priest got shafted pretty hard.
Yeah.
So,
see.
All right, now moving on to the rogue class. We start off with a card called Deadly Fork. It's 3-mana 3/2 death that'll add a 3/2 weapon to your hand, and I believe the weapon costs 3 mana,
which makes the card bad.
This card sucks.
Yeah.
No, it seemed good when I first looked at it, and then I realized that you don't have time to play 3 mana to equip a 3/2 weapon. That's what deadly poison is for.
No, not even that. You don't have time to play a 3 mana 3/2.
I'd say if it gave you the weapon and let you equip it immediately, then this card would be really crazy.
Or if it gave you like a 1 mana weapon, that'd be.
Or
pretty
give you 1 mana, then it would be like it'd be
somewhat
playable.
Balanced and decent. Yeah.
But if it's 3 mana, it's nigh unplayable.
You know what's the benefit of this card?
Nizoth.
No. It doesn't take that much slots in your deck. Everything's in one package.
Wow.
You don't have to run Deadly Poison.
It's for that special Reno Rogue deck, huh?
It's not too... Reno Rogue's a bad deck, so you just take what you get. So
yeah.
This might be good in Reno Rogue, but that doesn't make it a good card. I think we agree on this one. This card.
I don't like this card.
It's slow. I tried testing it so much, but it does really, really awkward to play.
Do you know what the weapon is? Is it a fork?
It is a fork. It's a very, very sharp fork.
Damn.
Sharper than this deadly fork.
But they're both 3 attack.
What?
But they're both 3 attack.
Yeah, both 3 attack.
Yeah, that doesn't. They're both 3/3 twos. One has 2 health. One has 2 durability.
Yeah. Initially, I thought this was 2 mana for 3/2 because that's
fiery war.
That's proper, right? Yeah, that's proper, right?
Is it proper though? Is fiery war?
No. I thought deadly fork itself was 2 mana for 3/2.
And then
it gives you a 3 mana 3/2 weapon. Then I thought it was like, oh, that's okay because
you're playing the weapon on curve.
But then I looked at this. I was like, why is this card 3 mana? It's not even on curve.
Like you're not gonna play this over SI7. Agent or whatever.
SI7 agent is so much better.
You have to spend the mana to play the 3/2, which is the weapon.
It's just not good.
Let's move. Moving on, we have the Ethereal Peddler. I don't know how to pronounce it, but I pronounce
Ethereal.
Is it Ethereal?
Yeah, Ethereal Peddler.
Nice.
Yeah.
Learn something every day.
So it's trying to play on the synergy of the stealing theme of Rogue.
Burgle effect.
The Burgle effect, which is just basically just stealing random cards. Not stealing random cards from your opponent's deck, from your opponent's class, so they're just completely random.
They stole the Priest mechanic.
No. Priest is a better stealer, did you know?
Yeah, Priest is a better stealer, but Rogue likes to steal like in a really terrible way.
Yeah.
Just stealing from, not from their deck, but from like not their actual cards, but just cards.
Class cards.
And it's a 5 mana 5/6. That's a Pit Fighter stat line, so it's like acceptable. Now is the effect warrant its playstyle? This reminds me of the Warlock C'Thun card, which is I forgot what it's called.
Usher of Souls.
Yeah, that card was something. That card was terrible, and it was like a noob trap for people who want to play Reno C'Thun.
Yeah. Yeah. But nobody plays it even in Reno C'Thun.
People tried to play it. Yeah. I didn't think it was bad.
No, because the Crazed Worshipper is just so much better. In a sense.
Yeah,
it's a taunt.
A taunt is just so much more valuable in the constructed metagame than having two more attack. And I don't think, again, with this thing, I don't see... It's crazier than Emperor Thorasan, if you think about it. Your entire hand is just stolen cards. But on average, if you want to build a stolen cards, like, or like a Burgle effect themed rogue, that deck is not going to be good because it's not consistent.
I think it might work. There's already Undercity Huckster. They're going to release that one mana 1/1 that,
which we'll talk about later.
Yeah, that's going to come up that we're going to see next.
The sheer value of reducing two mana, though, might just be so good.
It could be good. Yeah. Yeah. The stat line on this thing is amazing, but, like, who knows? I think it'll give rise to some kind of tempo rogue that bases it.
Runs those cards.
Yeah.
It runs Burgle and runs Undercity Huckster.
And then you one drop.
I don't know. I just don't see this card scene. Yeah.
The one drop.
It's not terrible.
Yeah, he's not terrible.
He's definitely better than Deadly Fork, but I
think if you run, like, say, a Raptor Rogue in it, it will be a strong, like, tempo deck. You Raptor Rogue the...
You have to run Burgle, though.
So, not Raptor Rogue, Unearthed Raptor.
Yeah, Raptor Rogue.
On the 2-mana 2/2, the Huckster.
Yeah.
Then you have two, like, cards from your opponent.
You have to play like, Burgle and stuff.
You don't have to play Burgle.
But, I mean, if you're playing this card, right, you're sort of... Not there's any. An expectation of a play Burgle.
I think that's a bit of a trap.
You're playing negative 1-mana Arcane Intellect, if you think about it.
Yeah, but you can just play this card in terms of just stat line alone, and then you can just, like, naturally just play...
You can play one Huckster. Copy. One copy.
Yeah, one copy. Yeah, one copy is fine.
For sure,
yeah.
in this deck. I just don't know if, like, you would build, like, base all your synergy off of that. I don't think you would.
No,
but one Burgle is definitely warranted because, like I said, it's like a negative one mana.
This could even be in a, like a Reno kind of rogue deck, although it's not that's optimal. But
who knows?
Yeah, who knows?
I like this card.
It's interesting. It has a powerful effect, but the effect it just doesn't have a place at the
moment. Yeah, because Burgle is pretty random too.
Yeah,
like
it's
the,
just a little bit too.
It might not even be worth.
The results are a little bit too polarizing.
Yeah.
All right. So moving on, we have the which is the card that we're talking about earlier.
Swash Burglar.
It's basically just the Undercity Huckster. That's one mana.
Or it's a Babbling Book.
Or it's a
for rogues.
It is battle.
I think this card is better than Babbling Book though. That's the thing.
Whew.
Isn't like I don't know.
Ooh. Actually, it is.
It's a pirate. It's a pirate. That's why it's better.
That gives it relevance somewhat.
Yeah. Remember that pirate card that we had? That's almost.
A pirate pirate warrior is better than pirate rogue. That's the thing.
Yeah.
Because they don't have the 30 mana. They don't
have
the
fiery
Bloodsail
X.
Bloodsail cultist is just crazy. That's the reason why pirate warrior.
We have the fork.
The fork ain't a pirate.
The fork ain't a pirate! Hey, what if the fork was a pirate? Would the deck be viable?
It might.
But it doesn't have Bloodsail Cultists. It's just
Anyway,
this card, I like it. Well, is he playing?
Rogue, okay, Rogue switches, Rogue skips their one drop so often that, like, in the previous expansion when they released the one Journey Below, the Journey Below spell, I thought that card wasn't that good. It turns out that you're not going to do anything turn one anyways, so you might as well just play that turn one. And then the ability to give yourself the on-curve play. Let's say you already have Undercity Huckster.
Yeah.
You pick the Unearthed Raptor. I guess Unearthed Raptor doesn't have Death Rattle, but you can pick anything. And then you could either pick the pet anything from the Huckster, and then you can go up to a Anubarak for control matchups, and you can basically just never lose against Control Warrior if you pick pick that.
Yeah.
Or you can pick Sylvanas, you can pick like a good mid-range minion, and so it ended up being a pretty good spell. Now, is the effect of discovering Death Rattle better than adding a random class card to your hand?
Definitely.
No, it's not. I mean, yeah, as in like, this is definitely worse than discovering a random Death Rattle, but the effect of the 5-minute Ethereal Peddler that we were talking about earlier might make this relevant enough to put it in that like archetype, the Burgle archetype.
Yeah.
And it also has that pirate tag. We can't forget that.
It is a pirate
tag.
So the pirate tag just makes
you can get really creative with it.
Unfortunately, it's not that relevant. It'll come up in some cases, basically, but I don't think people will make a build around it.
It's like this. When you play Rogue, especially when they don't run one drops, but when they do, they usually run a very sticky kind of one drop, like an Argent Squire, as we see in the Aggressive Miracle Rogue kind of build. Would you run Argent Squire over this card?
Yes.
I probably would if I'm running like stuff like Cold Bloods and stuff like that.
When you're talking about like creating new archetypes,
like
Pirate or like Beast or like whatever, you need like one card that's so powerful that it carries archetype on its own. For like Hunter, with like Call of the Wild, that's like single-handedly saved mid-range Hunter, because basically the whole point of the deck, like even though the individual minions on curve from 1 to 6 out of the high main aren't that great, all you're doing is just stalling the game,
up until turn
and you get to play your OP card. For I guess for Secret Paladin, all your cards are crazy, and then the PhD 6.
Yeah, that's how you get to remove all PhD these secrets that you can actually be played.
So I don't think this card, and for Pirate, and the most relevant example that is like comparable to this is the for Pirate Warrior is the Bloodsail Cultist, which is a ridiculous effect because it's an effect that takes effect immediately, and if you play like it synergizes perfectly with a card that they also got in expansion, which is the N'Zoth's First Mate, and it actually synergizes perfectly. You play that, you play your Bloodsail Corsair. or you play your Bloodsail Raider, and then you play your Bloodsail Cultist, get a 2-4 mm-hmm. weapon, and that's pretty crazy. Mm-hmm. This, I don't see the synergy here.
Yeah, I don't see that synergy at all. I guess, like, there's other pirates that actually do buff up this card, and this does allow another pirate that buffs itself.
You have to run the neutral pirates, the thing. Yeah.
With what's that 4-3 pirate called, again?
The 4-3 pirate, it's the...
The Shady Dealer.
Yeah, the Shady Dealer, yeah, it gets buffed if you have pirate.
That's the thing, it's just not impactful enough.
Yeah, it's not impactful. Yeah, it doesn't stick on the board long enough, but this is one of the only enablers for that card.
And 4 damage is, like, relatively...
It's a 5-4.
It's a 5-4 after for 3 mana. Yeah,
4 damage is relatively easy to do in this meta. Like, a lot of people are running stuff like Shadow Bolt.
Yeah.
Just to deal with, like... Back with the old expansion, 4 damage was, like, basically everywhere, but, like, True Silver and stuff like that. But
and Death Spite.
And
man.
Death Spite was, like, the biggest offender, which was why Tomb Pillager wasn't that great. Mm-hmm. And then... But specifically, I don't know. The 3-mana pirate is not that good, and it's also not a pirate in itself, which makes it so that
that kind of just makes it not so good.
I definitely don't think a pyro is going to take place.
But something like a burgle kind of rogue, maybe.
You know what they want to encourage? They want to encourage pirate stealing cards with burgle.
I love the flavor.
Yeah, you like it, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
Maybe if they release like one or two more.
Probably. It's not ready yet. I feel like it's not ready yet.
Yeah. I feel like this might see a little bit of play. And if it works...
For the same reason as Journey Below, just because they often skip their one drop, might as well just put something like this in your deck.
All right,
so the next class that we're doing is Shaman, and the first card that we're going to be discussing is the Maelstrom Portal. And I think this card, like, it doesn't seem too... it seems pretty underwhelming. Like, one damage doesn't do that much, and a one drop's not that impactful. But I actually see it being used in a really specific archetype as a one-off. Actually, in Aggro Shaman, the famous Zixor list that everyone's running at the moment, a lot of people are making this prediction too, which is why I'm sort of like jumping on the bandwagon. But what like a current Chinese list is doing is basically taking out the one Flame Juggler, because it's bad in the current meta with Alexstrasza as a champion, Fiery War Axe, etc. That trades really well with the 2-3. Instead, they're replacing that with a Lightning Storm. And this could replace the Lightning Storm, because this can be used as a proactive card and can also be used to deal one damage, which Shaman kind of struggles with. And it also fills the niche that's left from Flame Juggler.
Interesting.
So it adds like...
I never thought of it that way.
It's like a three-prong thing. And
it's a three-prong.
Adding that one Lightning Storm in that aggro deck actually made it a lot more consistent, because it's not even that bad against control decks when they like leave like a few low-health minions. You can use it to just clear it off. Mm-hmm. And against aggro decks, it's like a complete game changer. Yeah. And just having one copy and sacrificing a not optimal card slot, since basically the deck was down to the cards like optimized to 29 cards.
Mm-hmm.
And then the one card that people weren't sure about is basically just called the Zixor list, but Zixor put in the Flame Juggler, and people have been like running with that for the longest time. And then now that people have been putting in Lightning Storm, this is a good replacement.
Yeah, it does Maybe. Really it help does, with the yeah. weaker matchup, which is a zoo too.
And of course it synergizes with the Spell Power Totem, which might be relevant.
Yeah.
In terms of replacing Lightning Storm though, it just doesn't do the...
The one damage doesn't seem impactful, but in many cases, you're using the Lightning Storm as a Whirlwind. And this is, in a meta where Whirlwind is such a good effect, I see the scene.
Who knows?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, who knows?
It doesn't buff Tunnel Drug, though.
It doesn't seem strong off, just by looking at it, but I see it seeing play. For that one specific slot in that specific archetype.
I see this in the Fringe Mally Ghost Shaman deck.
I don't see it in the Control Shaman though, for sure, because it's not impactful.
It doesn't replace the Elemental Destruction at all.
Lightning Storm and Lava Shock.
If you run Mally Ghost, you might as well run this cheap removal. Yeah.
Unless you want to run them all. You run all the board clears.
You play Emperor and then Mally Ghost and Maelstrom Portal.
Yeah.
I don't know. This card is okay.
Play with Hollow Zeal, get some heals.
Yeah.
That being said, it's not very good, I don't think.
I think it's not a great card like in a vacuum. But it's a good card in the sense that it'll see like fringe use in that specific archetype.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Plus, you might get a cool one drop.
Yeah. Like you might get Tunnel Drop.
Yeah.
And then that's when your opponent just like screams RNG and like this guy is better than me.
He'll add you after the game.
Yeah. Add you after the game. Yeah. They have to have added more portal cards and more RNG cards into the set. And it's just one of them. Yeah. I guess a one cause isn't too impactful.
So next we have Spirit Claws. It's a new weapon. 1 mana, 1/3.
Looks good, but it sucks.
It's a Fiery War Axe.
It's better than a Fiery War Axe.
It's better than a Fiery War Axe.
It costs one less.
I know.
The thing is, what 2-drop or even 3-drop or even 4-drop minions give you spell power?
How do you get that spell power without screwing yourself?
The question is, how skilled are you to consistently get your spell power totem on turn 2?
The question is, why wouldn't you just play a totem golem?
Yeah, why wouldn't you just play totem golem? when instead of hero power, why don't you just don't run this card and then just play totem tunnel trog into totem goal? Yeah. This is what people have been doing for like the past year.
Why did we even need this card?
This card sucks.
I don't know.
This card sucks.
I like the idea of it.
Yeah,
it
I like the idea of it. It seems so good when it
came at a wrong time.
Yeah. Maybe when they add more, like, when they add better Kobold Geomancers, or if they put this in Mage.
Yeah.
Yeah, they put this in Mage.
Or maybe if you put this in Mage, I believe
it'd be pretty 3 mana, doable. Like, 2, 3 plus 3 attack or some crap like that.
The only playable spell power minions in the current meta are Azuric,
Blood Mage Thanos,
and that's pretty much it, I believe.
There's also the Tempo Mage cards.
Yeah, but that's a Shaman card.
Yeah.
For the purposes of theory crafting, you add in the C'Thun 2 mana 3/2 that has plus 1 spell power. That's playing Tempo Mage. This card is a Shaman card, so you're not going to see those cards being played together.
Yeah.
Even Stoneforged Axe is better than this card.
Yeah.
True.
Yep. I don't see it being played.
Yeah,
same. Until they add more spell power minions, of course.
Yeah. Like on curve.
Or maybe they'll add some sort of like aura effect where like, you play some sort of spell and it gives you spell power for like 5 turns. There's only
kind of like Embrace of Shadow, but with
something like that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That MIC play. But for now, bad card. Bad card?
Agreed.
Bad card. Yeah.
And the last card that we're going to be talking about for Shaman is the Wicked Witch Doctor, which is 4 mana, 3/4, and the effect is when you cast a spell, summon a random basic totem. What are your thoughts?
It makes the totem carver kind of playable.
I like it. It's kind of cool.
That's synergy.
Like this card. Yeah. I don't like its stats, but that's fair for its effect. The problem is the random basic totem.
Basic totems suck, though. That's the thing.
Yeah.
Yeah,
and there's not many. There's not that many cards that take advantage of you having a lot of totems on the board.
There's Primal Fusion.
Yeah, there's Primal Fusion.
And then there's the Drenna Totem Carver.
That isn't really a relevant card, though, if you think about it.
It's not.
It doesn't it doesn't swing the board in a way that it's just a fat minion if you have a lot of totems.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not. I don't think that's good enough, to take a card slot in basically just replace aggro or midrange shaman as it is right now.
Mm-hmm.
I can see this being played in decks where you don't want to spam totems, but sometimes you want.
I don't know. It's not good in spell shaman decks because you're running stuff like Elemental Destruction. This card obviously doesn't synergize with Elemental Destruction, and it has to be built in decks where you're playing a lot of spells and you care about getting totems. Is that a viable deck archetype? I don't think so. And even if that was a viable deck archetype, is generating totems something that you want to do?
No, especially maybe. For its stats.
Sometimes, actually. Yeah. No, for certain matchups, against Warrior, if you get a ton of totems, it's hard to deal with.
If the
totems are just buffing each other and doing, annoying things.
They're not buffing each other if they're just totems, though.
You want some minis.
You're
on
comboing them with Bloodlust or Flame Tongue, then it's doing something. Yeah. If you do this with, the 5 mana 3/6, the stakes. I forgot what it's called.
Thunder Bluff.
Yeah. Stakes. That's the application. That was the card that we were talking about.
Yeah.
I don't remember. I just call it stakes.
It also makes things from below cost nothing at that point. Yeah. You just have all these totems out.
Yeah, it does synergize with
that. That actually might be relevant.
That's what I'm thinking. You play this thing, you get some spells out, then you play a thing from below.
Thunder, yeah.
And before that, you play some.
Yeah, this also synergizes with thing from below.
Yeah, you can play some good minis before this,
I'm seeing more synergy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, when I first looked at this card, I immediately thought it was garbage.
That being said, Shaman is already pretty good on its own how it is. I don't think Seal is improving the deck archetype.
There's a lot of cards that are competing in all Shaman archetypes.
Especially at the 4 slot now with Flaming Faithless
Would you
Master
of Evolution.
You want the 4 mana
Master
7/7.
Of Evolution. Yeah. Why would you play this over that?
Exactly.
Who knows?
Yeah. Well, Master of Evolution actually isn't currently seeing play because
of Flame Wreath Faceless.
Because all the Shaman minions, if you think, they're not good to be evolved. Totem Golem's not a good. You evolve Feral Spirit. The wolves are two drops. Flame Wreath Faceless is obviously garbage. So the 2, 3, and 4 are all bad.
But no, Tuskarga Totemic is something you want to evolve because it's a 3-drop.
And you don't want to evolve totems. The evolved deck never really sort of picked up because first of all these are all basic totems, so then if you evolve a full board, if you do Onyxia evolve, you have a 16% chance of getting a Doomsayer, so it's actually pretty bad. You're doing 10 mana combo and you're putting in 2 situation cards into your deck.
16%
for a chance, it's 16% with an Onyxia on an empty board and playing evolve.
Playing Onyxia in a Shaman,
so basically I don't see that's a different argument for a different time, but I don't that's why Master of Evolution isn't seeing play right now basically. But I actually think this is better than Master of Evolution for the sole purposes of not that it's a better card in a vacuum, but it has more applications that it synergizes with Thunder Bluff, it synergizes with the thing from below, and it also gives you the one time You sometimes run Primal Fusion as a one-off, and that's when it's good. It's just the most crazy with Thunderbluff.
However, again, you have to consider you have to run a bunch of spells to get this thing working, and you don't really want to play that many spells.
You run Lightning Bolt and Rock better, that's it.
And then you get overloaded, and it kind of sucks.
Yeah. I think it is an okay card, but people have to do a lot of theorycraft.
Yeah, my verdict is right now it's not that good, so we won't see play.
Yeah. Alright, so yeah, that's the Shaman class.
Yeah.
Alright, so the next class that we're going to be discussing is the Warlock class, and the first card we're going to be talking about is Karazhan, or what I like to call Muster for Disney. So it's a 5 mana spell, and it summons a 1-1 Candle, a 2-2 Broom, and a 3-3 Teapot, and these are all just placeholder names. They're actually just vanilla minions. So basically, the first card that this reminds you of is Silver Hand Knight, which is like the most overused comparison that everyone's been using. And the difference between this and Silver Hand Knight is that this is a spell. And
you have a 3-3 and a 1-1 body over a 4-4.
Yeah, and that flexibility might actually make it better than Silver Hand Knight. I'm not sure if it does. In most cases, in the archetype that you're most likely to play this in, which is Reno Lock, the flexibility probably matters more than having a 4-4 than a 3-3 and a 1-1.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So I would say that the main thing that this card has going for it is that it synergizes with Cho'Gall. What are your thoughts on that?
Ooh, that's interesting. Cho'Gall.
It's pretty good. Yeah, 7 pretty mana, good. And then you play this card, take 5 damage, get the minions.
Yeah,
it's like
7,
a new 7,
Dr. 3-3, 2-2, and a 1-1. That's pretty good.
When Cho'Gall first came out, people were like, wow, this is actually a pretty good card.
They released it when they didn't announce the Molten Giant nerf.
Yeah.
So therefore, it was an amazing card.
And there's like another, there's another synergistic aspect of it, in the sense of, in the form of the Molten Giants. And then with this, the difference with back then and now is that with the Molten Giants, Reno Lock or Hand Lock could get away with not playing that many spells, and then Cho'Gall still being good because you just hold on to it and do a gigantic swing turn with Molten Giants. Since you can't do that anymore, you need to run a few more spells. This might be the spell that tips it over to the point where you actually want to play something like Cho'Gall.
Yeah.
For all intents and purposes, you want to run Cho'Gall to like combo with Siphon Soul or like Shadow Flame, but this just gives you an option for when you don't have those in your hand, and you can still make a proactive play, summon a 7/7, and then summon a 0 mana or -5 health, which is a 2 relevant Reno Lock, and you summon a 6/6 with the stats, split up into 3 bodies.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I think this card isn't that bad.
It's okay.
Yeah, it's decent.
It's not great.
But if you're playing it on turn 5, like it sort of contests the board. And the main thing with it is Cho'Gall, because it gives you some more Cho'Gall synergy.
I also like how it's a spell, so Yogg-Saron can definitely give you these cards.
Yeah, I love spells. Oh, man.
Cards don't have to be amazing for you to run them in decks, because they just serve specific purposes, or like they fill weaknesses or synergies that your deck is lacking.
Yeah, it definitely.
And this screams out to me as one of those cards.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yep.
So I'd rate this card as like it's pretty playable in the current meta, especially with Cho'Gall.
But I don't think it would see that much play.
It's okay.
We'll see.
I still think it's not good enough that Cho'Gall can actually make an appearance.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because right now nobody's running Cho'Gall.
Cho'Gall Siphon Soul is so good, though.
Yeah, I know, but it's like...
And this makes it so that you can play Cho'Gall for when you don't get Cho'Gall Siphon Soul.
True. But it's just that the meta is so aggressive. It's when you play Cho'Gall
and you lose 5 life.
Yeah, you lose 5 life. Yeah. That hurts, man. That hurts.
Well, you can always just play it without Cho'Gall. 5 mana, I get all these minions. Why not?
I'd rather play it as a 5 mana card.
Than Silverhand Knight?
Than Silverhand Knight. Because you still have that 1-1 for flexibility. Like, I use Abusive Sergeant on it if I do run it.
I think this would be a pretty good mage spell, actually.
It is a good mage spell.
It would fuel Yogg.
But that would be pretty strong, because it's a good kind of tempo card.
Yeah. That's why you're wondering why people don't run Silverhand Knight.
Yeah.
So, okay. And Kraxximus thinks it's terrible, like all the other
I don't
cards.
Think it's terrible. It's
okay. Yeah, all right. So moving on to the next card. We have Malakazar's Inn, which is actually one of...
Malchazar.
I don't know the two pronunciations.
I think it's a hard CH.
I think it's Malchazar.
For sure?
Malchazar.
Because they pronounced it in the prologue. I played it like a week ago, so I forgot.
I had my audio like turned
off.
Yeah.
I like Malchazar better. It sounds...
Let's just go by Malchazar.
Aesthetically speaking, no.
I think aesthetically speaking, Malchazar is also better.
No. You're making it sound like cheese, man.
It sounds too similar to Malkorok. We might as well call him Malchorok.
Fuck this guy. Sup. Yeah. Anyways, on to Malchazar's Imp.
Yeah.
Whenever you discard a card, draw a card, it's a 1 mana, 1/3 minion.
It's a demon.
It's a demon.
And it's a demon. Ooh. It has so many things going for it. The problem is, is this going to make this card decks viable?
I'll tell you this right now. I've been playing Discard Warlocks since it came out. Damn, it's crazy.
Crazy, as in like it demolishes decks?
It does. The tempo swings are too strong.
The tempo swings are amazing, but
it's
that...
It's dependent, though.
It's polarizing.
So yeah, it is.
It is polarizing, but I don't know. I'm probably getting really lucky. Because I've always had
Silverware Golem.
Yeah,
or the Fisted Taraxes. I just demolish it. You know how strong those turns are.
When you discard specifically the right cards at the right time, then it's absolutely ridiculous.
Yeah. And this also draws the right cards back. Too.
Yeah. So it's like basically you're playing a 0-mana 3/3 that negates the discard effect and draws you a card. That's absolutely ridiculous.
And you know the cards that discard cards, they're undercosted. That's why
that's absolutely absurd. But the problem is, of course, it requires you to discard the right card.
Yeah.
And then that's just inherently going to be random because you can't control your
deck. That being said, you can cater the deck to maximize just dumping your hand and discarding cards, specific ones.
I haven't, like I said, I haven't experimented with these cards, so I wouldn't know. I know that the results are going to be polarizing. So you're going to have to play a lot of games to like try to get a relevant sample size. So you can see how often you get super lucky, and if that like number of times of getting super lucky is worth it for you to be running a discard deck over the like classic Zoo deck, which is just tried and true and is just not that bad.
Mm-hmm. The discard deck is less board-centric than the Zoo deck and more...
No, it just relies on like gigantic board swings.
Right off the bat.
Yeah, right off the bat with this card.
Yeah. That being said, Malkazar's Imp, it's... I wouldn't say it's great. I'd say it's all right. It's decent.
Does it have a place in that deck, though? Is drawing a card going to be that relevant when what you're aiming to do is to make your card like hand empty so you can hit the right cards with your discard?
It kind of is. Although I can't say absolute certainty, but you know Darkshire Librarian? The one that discards a card when you play it, but you draw a card when it dies?
So it draws two cards now.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's fantastic.
And also, when he discards a card, it immediately plays the Silverware Golem.
Exactly. It triggers that.
Or Fist of Draxus. Yeah, now that I think about it, that's so ridiculous.
Yeah, and it's especially insane with Doomguard.
The problem is, like, all the effects are random. So your start is going to be totally dependent on whether or not you discard the right
card. It's random in the beginning. Once you've dumped your hand, it's controlled.
That is true.
And then it becomes draw dependent. But with the Warlock Hero power, it increases the chance of getting the right cards.
You top deck everything.
I'm going to say this is a good card. It's definitely good.
Yeah, I would say it's a good card. The stats are pretty good. It definitely got a stick, too, right?
Yeah. And it's a good stat line. And it's a demon, which I don't think is that relevant.
Sense demons. Dude, like after Standard came in, all the demons were gone. I was sad.
Yeah. They got rid of Voidcaller.
I know.
The strongest demon.
I know.
Then this is also a nerf to Bane of Doom.
Yeah, it feels bad. Oh, yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Is it a nerf to Bane of
Doom? Oh, what if you have Soulfire from Peddler?
Yeah, I think it's better than, like, is it better than Succubus? As the body, obviously not, but like...
I think overall, it's better than Succubus.
No.
It's not?
If you have a discard effects in your deck, then it's
better. Sure, sure. If you have the discard effect, sure.
Yeah.
Otherwise, Succubus is better.
Yeah.
Turn one this, turn two Succubus. Get the Silver Mogul.
Not like you're playing Insane.
Okay, yeah, that snowball is kind of disgusting. Yeah.
People aren't playing Bane of Doom anyways. Like I said, if you play with the discard archetype, it's just crazy when it goes off.
And it has to be aggressive.
Yeah. Okay. I like this card, and it's also the effect is interesting.
Will it make the game broken, though?
Will it make...
annoying ass...
It'll make it more RNG-oriented.
Yeah,
it'll make it
more... Yeah, it's more RNG-oriented. Like,
especially since there's no death rattle means right now. Yeah. Stuff like 3-mana 3-3s, or 0-mana 3-3s, and 4 random damage. That 4 random damage will usually clear a minion.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it'll clear that minion cleanly, too.
Yeah.
So it'll fist it. It is pretty crazy.
All right,
man. I like this card. So all right,
let's take a look at this one.
And on the last card, we were just talking about this with the Silverware Golem, and this card is zero with the Malkazar's Imp. It's a 0-mana 3/3 that draws you a card. Now, how OP is
plus you
OP,
played a card
for plus it negated the discard
exactly
effect. Because the fact that you're replacing the discard effect with, like, if you discard this minion, you summon it, it means that you're playing the overcosted card at no drawback, but at an upside.
You mean undercosted.
Yeah, the undercosted card. You're playing the Succubus, the 2-mana 4-3.
The 2-mana 4-3 to put a 3-3 on the board and draw a card.
Or it does 4 random damage to a minion or a character, which is just ridiculous. So if the discard Warlock is good, this is obviously good. I haven't tried. I haven't experimented with the Warlock card yet. I like this card. If they print more cards like this, the discard deck would definitely take off.
It's here's the thing.
Once someone finds the optimal curve.
It's fun when you're playing it, but imagine playing against it.
You're just like, please don't discard the Golem. Yeah, please don't discard the Fist of
So Jackson. It could be another frustrating deck.
Yeah, I'm not looking forward to this. But it's an interesting card.
It's interesting.
There was
it's
nothing
good.
Like this that's ever been released before.
Yeah. Fist of Draxus.
Well, other than the Fist of Draxus. But then those two cards are
what... Fist of Draxus have been good.
It's good now when the deck has been built to cater to it.
Have you played the top two Tavern Brawl, like where you only run, you could run 15 copies of each card?
I have run it.
Before the Mech Warper Metal Tooth Leaper got popular, I was playing the Soul Fire Fist of Draxus. And when you got the right, when you discarded the right cards, it was so stupid. Because they would be at like 8, like 4 life on turn 2. Yeah,
if you did it with Darkshire Librarian, you would never run out of fuel.
Yeah, that was pretty dumb. And this just gives me PTSD from that.
Alright.
Yeah, I like this card. I like this card.
Powerful card.
And it's pretty great.
Yeah.
Not even bad for a 3-drop. 3-mana, 3/3, standard, vanilla. Yeah.
Kind of card that would lock you down. Like, you play Doomguard, double Silverware Golem. Oh.
Yeah. Or I think you mean 8 damage to the face, plus the 5, so that's 13. That's great.
And draw 2 cards. Why not?
And draw 2 cards.
Draw 2 cards. It's like Ancient of Lore. How can you beat that?
If Ancient of Lore is good, why don't you just make it 5 mana? Yeah. Give it charge, give it plus 2 health, and make it summon 2 3/3s and draw 2 cards.
I swear to God, this card, like, this deck itself is going to tilt me so hard on ladder.
Yeah.
I was like, what is this?
Because the difference between discarding the right card and discarding the wrong card is...
Huge.
Like, yeah, it's huge. Absolutely massive. It's like the same thing as people were complaining about, like, a lot of prominent pros like Reynad were complaining about things like Flame Juggler that affect the board that early, based solely off of RNG, and this is exactly the same thing, except it's even more polarizing because it's not one damage. It's a 3/3 minion. And it also affects whether or not you discard a card.
Yeah.
Because if you discard this, you play it. So
I would say this.
The more I talk about it, the more like
here's my prediction.
The more it makes me vomit a little bit.
It's going to be a great deck.
Yeah.
But it is.
Blizzard, it's going to be frustrating.
They're
going to
stop printing these kinds of cards because it's going to be so frustrating.
Yeah. It's worse than Fiery Bat and Flame Juggler.
Do you see them printing a Shielded Minibot?
Minibot is arguably less like frustrating than this. Because Minibot, you know what you're dealing with. This is like 50-50 of him winning the game and losing the game.
Yeah. I agree with that.
Not only did he have to draw this card, he had to discard it.
The right card. They had to discard the right card for me to lose this game. It's so stupid.
Yeah. Oh dear.
Well, so yeah, there's your Warlock cards.
All right, now we're on to our last class, Warrior, and the first card we have is Fool's Bane, which at first glance is absolutely amazing. 5 mana, 3/4 weapon, unlimited attacks each turn. Can attack heroes.
This is my favorite card of the set, and I have a little bit of a bias because Warrior is my favorite class. I have like 2,000 wins or something like that on Warrior.
That's a huge bias.
It's a huge bias.
Resident Sleeper.
This card is like, it's like right now it replaces what Deathspite left when it got rotated out of Standard. It's filling a void for Control Warrior, which is basically just like a targeted brawl. Yeah. And this might be the card.
Yeah.
The first synergy I see with this card is with the 3-mana 4/3, which makes your hero immune.
Yes.
Oh,
and you can
boy.
What you can do with this is you can just in one turn use all the charges and clear everything and not take any life.
5 mana, deal 12 damage spread across like
a bunch
one,
of
whatever you want.
This card single-handedly makes the Zoo matchup and the Zoo versus Warrior matchup even worse for the Zoo.
And not only that, you don't have to use all the charges.
Yeah, you can just save them. You can just equip this thing and not even use any charges. And then the next turn, whatever they play will die. Because you can attack unlimited times. So I think this card is definitely a really good one-off in a Control Warrior. I just don't know...
It just doesn't see... The issue is the reduced utility in hitting face.
Yeah.
Like, even Gore Howl, it's a board control card, but... Yeah. You know,
you can still use it to go face.
Yeah, for a huge amount of damage.
The thing is, if you run it as a one-off, then you won't really run into the issue where you're forced to use it to go face. And it's often... You're going to use it to hit... Like, there's going to be at least one target for this, and you can use that to kill those minions.
Well, the problem as a one-off, the main one, is the chances of drawing it. You really want to turn 5.
But that doesn't make it a bad card, right?
No.
There's a lot of cards in the game that are really good, and you run them as one-offs. Mm-hmm. Like, I mean, Reno Lock is a thing, right? And you run 30 runoffs.
Because.
Yeah, because of Reno. But, like, and you run Gore Howl as a one-off. So this is sort of like, this is really comparable to Gore Howl, except it's, like, slightly less versatile. But you could argue that it's more versatile in terms of, like, minion control. Because you can use, it's flexible and you can use it on multiple minions.
Yeah, one thing I did think of, actually, is Spiteful Smith and this card. Like, does that is that gonna make that
sounds disgusting?
Is it gonna make that card viable?
No. I don't think it will though, because Spiteful Smith is like it's just not impactful enough.
But this weapon alone,
it's ridiculous. It's 20 damage.
Yes.
But 20 damage isn't going face though. That's the thing. Like, yeah, when it's hitting strictly on minions, it can't be that broken.
Yeah. But there is a difference between hitting something with 3 health and something with a little more.
It will, but then, okay.
It means you take half the damage. Yeah. Plus, you save another charge.
I don't think it'll make running a 5 mana 4-6 viable enough, though.
We'll see. I don't know.
Well, this card is definitely like on my radar.
I like
one of the best cards in the set.
Yeah.
And one of the most interesting cards in the set.
It can definitely allow for like different possibilities.
Yeah, I really like this card. Yeah, I don't know. It might end up being just redundant and bad, but I don't know. I just hope this card becomes playable.
It's unique.
You can run this with upgrade.
Ooh.
It wouldn't go.
That's not even that good with upgrade, because upgrade is like a face card, right?
Yeah.
Like, okay, the thing with control decks is you can't run light cards. When people first made like the first iterations of control, C'Thun Warrior, back when Whispers of the Old Gods released, the reason it was bad was because people were running like multiple copies of the Beckoner of Evil. They're running a bunch of like light cards.
They're running as a tempo.
Yeah, they're running as a tempo deck and then having the gain 10 armor. That doesn't make any sense. Yeah. So you can't run cards like upgrade with this.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What about Captain Greenskin?
Captain Green.
It is upgrade. It's a 5/4 body.
Greenskin. It might be so good with this that I don't know. Yeah, Captain Greenskin is.
I'm just thinking of ways of how this
can run
really
both
just
Gore Howl and this, and have Captain Greenskin in the deck, and it also works with Fiery War Axe. Like, you can play like Fiery War Axe and like hold it for like 2 turns, coin the Captain Greenskin, and now you have like a 4/3 weapon, and then pretty good combo. You could coin Fool's Bane, then play the Captain Greenskin, and that's
you have five charges.
4/5, and you can kill 4/5 health minions. The question is like, will you have enough life?
As
warrior, you probably will. Actually.
You'll clear the board, so therefore, like
you're not taking that much. The only damage you're taking is from the weapon.
Yeah.
So I like this card definitely. I like this card.
If I'm going to see this card being played everywhere, I'm going to run Harris on each and every one of my decks.
Yeah, that might be...
You monster!
All to include.
Yeah, that's the other thing to consider. Yeah. That's going to come back in. Harrison will be like very strong.
If this becomes popular... Well, if any weapon becomes popular, Harrison becomes like the hero to come saving the day.
Yeah,
but
this...
Yeah.
I can see this card being disgusting.
Not only Harrison, but like a couple of Boozes as well.
The thing is, this destroys like slow... Like fat... Like really quick decks. Like Zoo.
Yeah.
And then those decks don't typically run Harrison. They run like Zoo specifically runs like one or two copies of Ooze. Usually one copy.
Mm-hmm. It runs my double Ooze deck.
it runs as like a tech card, sort of like Crazed Alchemist for Doomsayer.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And the thing with this card though is it doesn't get countered by Ooze, because you can use all the charges the turn you play.
Oh yeah, that's the charges you play.
So this Harrison might not even counter this. You can just play it, clear their entire board. It's like a targeted brawl, basically.
Issue is you don't want to equip this and hold it.
Yeah, you don't want to hold it. Then. Yeah, then you probably don't want to hold this card.
Yeah.
Okay.
We were already discussing the strategies.
Yeah.
All
right.
That's a very interesting
good
card.
Yeah, good card. Interesting card. Good design. Yeah. I like it.
Beautiful artwork.
And the next card we're talking about is going to be the last portal, which is the Ironforge portal. It's a 5 mana spell, gain 4 armor, and summon a random 4 cost minion. And this is like the Moonglade portal that we're talking about earlier. Resembles Shield Maiden in a lot of ways. And now the question is this better than Shield Maiden, or is this worse than Shield Maiden?
The better question is this better than Moonglade portal?
I
think it is, because within the context of warrior, that is relevant.
Gaining 4 armor.
As opposed to Moonglade portals, restore 6 health.
The thing is, if you could restore health to your minions specifically in a deck where that matters, where you're running stuff like Ancient of War, where you're running Violet Teacher, where you're running like Emperor Thorazon, when you're going to heal those minions, the restore 6 health is arguably like more versatile. This only has synergy with Shield Slam, and it's only like better if you are at max health and don't have targets to hit. Like, I don't have minions to heal.
All right, you know what? I relent. Moonglade Portal's pretty good.
Moonglade Portal's pretty good. Because of its
flexibility. Oh, you change your mind now.
I was giving a thought throughout this whole
thing.
And
it synergizes with Yogg.
It's not bad. And it synergizes with the Violet Teacher.
People have actually recently been playing a Yogg Warrior deck. It sort of resembles OTK Warrior, and it also has Yogg in it.
Yeah.
It's pretty interesting. And this will definitely see a place in that deck, making it better. I don't know if this will see playing Control Warrior, though.
It's like a Shield Maiden.
Ever since Nax and GVG got rotated out, the 5-drop slot has been completely uncontested. It's only been Azure Drake, pretty much. And this is the card that comes in and saves the 5-drop slot for Warrior.
So you get a random 4-drop and 4 health.
Yeah, and that's good enough. People were like, Shield Maiden is not good enough, because restoring 5 life, it's not that good. To 5 mana 5/5 is not that good. But this is... First of all, it costs one mana less.
You said, people said...
Yeah, people said Shield Maiden was not that good.
Really?
A lot of reviewers said Shield Maiden was not that good.
No, Shield Maiden was crazy from the offset.
No, it wasn't. That's the thing. A lot of people... In a review, like in an expansion, where people say Dr. Boom is not that good, where people say Patron is not that good, I expect far less quality of reviews from like the most popular streamers and reviewers.
Damn!
Ooh. This card...
Shots fired.
If you think about it, Shield Maiden was competing in a meta where there were cards like Cairn and Sylvanas being played. This is a 5 cost. The only spell, the only card competing with this is Azdrake.
Yeah.
Like, virtually the only card that's competing with this is Azdrake. And Azdrake isn't played in control here because it doesn't have any practical application. You're not looking for a 5 mana 4-4 spell power that draws a card. You're looking for sustain or removal. And this gives you, like, it gives you tempo and it gives you life.
Sustain, and it's interesting with Shield Slam.
Oh. And it's a spell that works with Yogg. So I see a lot of promise for this. Ooh. In this, yeah.
So much in one pack.
Plus, yeah. Oh!
It's sort of like Moonglade Portal.
We never considered this, but all these portals synergize with Yogg.
Yeah.
Oh, no. I mean, Yogg can cast all these portals.
Oh. Shit. Yeah. Now your Yogg can cast Ironforge Portal, giving you more armor.
Damn.
That's pretty dumb.
What a buff.
And a 4-drop.
I actually feel like Yogg is going to be banned in future formats from tournaments. Not because, like... It's because when spells like Astral Communion rotate out, the card is just gonna be too good.
Yeah, it is too good.
Like, it's not just too impactful. Too
it yeah. does
not only. Okay, it's not even about the RNG aspect. It's just too good.
Yeah, you're giving it it's too good. Yeah, it's too many good spells now.
Yeah, there's too many good spells. Yeah.
And it's bullshit. It feels like shit when you lose to Yogg.
Yeah, you do.
If you play like 3 or 4 portal, yeah, and also like just for most casual viewers, it like casts like a huge shadow of doubt on like the integrity of competitive Hearthstone.
Yeah, it does.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And this might be like this is like the next Shield block. Oh, he got exactly the right Ironforge portal at the right time to save him from lethal, and it gave him the minion that he needed to trade into their
Gave him a charge minion or a taunt.
Yeah. Oh, this gives you Core Guard Elite, it's like ridiculous. Yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Ooh. So much damage.
Yeah. The more I think about this guy, the more I think it's better.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's better than Moogly Portal, because like I said, Moogly Portal has the added versatility.
They belong in different archetypes. Yeah, they do. Though, yeah. So yeah. It's hard to say.
They're both good cards though, and I really like this card, and I think it has promise. Especially in Control Warrior.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Also synergy.
And so for the last card that we're going to talk about is the arguably the worst one. Or not really arguably, it's objective.
Arguably, it's objective.
Yeah, it's
Protect
objective.
The King, which is Unleash the Taunts.
Yeah.
So each 3 mana spell. Ooh. For each enemy minion, summon a 1-1 pawn with taunt. Now, are 1-1 minions good enough right now? No, they're not.
Of course they're not.
And the second comparison to make is Charge better than Taunt? Obviously it is. Mm-hmm. Taunt is far worse than Charge and is way more costly. Really? Except that both of these spells cost 3 mana. Yeah. So why is Unleash... So why would this card ever be played if Unleash isn't even like that
because
great?
Of the card Bolster.
Bolster.
Yeah, see, then if you think about the situations where it's good, let's say you have like 4 or 5 minions, you play Protect the King Bolster. Is that even that good, and it requires to have 2 situational cards that don't work well individually?
If you build a deck to draw cards,
specifically,
like
and all have run it like all like with exclusively taunts. I don't know.
I've tried this deck. Like, I tried to build it around it. It's actually not as impactful as you think it is. Even if you're playing against...
I didn't think it was impactful.
Yeah, no. Because I thought it was impactful because you get the whole board of 3-3
not
taunts,
really,
right?
Not really, because...
But you're pretty much behind on board while you do that. And you really need charge to instantly remove those kind of... your opponent's board. But, yeah, your opponent can easily wait, like, set up, and then just remove all the taunts altogether.
Not only that, when you play this card, you play a good card like Ravaging Ghoul, which is a really good card in the meta.
Yeah.
It does not synergize.
Ravaging Ghoul just sort of just dump, like,
yeah, it's
a
counterintuitive.
Lot, makes a lot of cards not viable.
Yeah, it's counterintuitive.
Yeah, and also, it makes, yeah, it also, yeah. You're playing this in Warrior, where you're almost,
you just
like, undoubtedly
on ones, yeah.
running Ravaging Ghoul. This does not synergize well with Ravaging Ghoul.
Unless you take out Ravaging Ghoul.
Unless... Yeah, that's pretty much blasphemy because it's Ravaging Ghoul.
It changes.
It's like taking out Fiery War Axe in this meta,
mm-hmm.
where all you're in, like the entire meta is just full of 2 mana drops, which die to 1 charge of Fiery War Axe. You're not gonna take Fiery War Axe out, just like you're not gonna take Ravaging Ghoul out when you have a 3-mana 3/3 that has a whirlwind effect. That's crazy.
Yeah.
And it was proven to be crazy. I was one of the people who thought I think Ravaging Ghoul was gonna be a good card. But I didn't think it was going
to
be like absolutely ridiculous.
You have
meta defining.
But the thing is that it replaced Death Spite.
Yeah, it replaced Death Spite. It filled the void of Death Spite.
Yeah.
And I think, and just because of Ravaging Ghoul, I already think this card is bad.
That being said, no, I have a different opinion on this card. I think it brings about a new archetype.
The Taunt Warrior.
Yes,
the Taunt Warrior. Yeah.
It might be the thing that swings it over the...
It's like this. When you build the Taunt Warrior, there's so many 3-drops that you can play too already.
But like the
Frenzy,
Monkey.
Like Frenzy Monkey. Like, Fierce would you Monkey. Play Frenzy Monkey? No, would you play this card over Frenzy Monkey?
This is Monkey. Yeah. Here's the thing.
Oh, Furious Monkey.
You cannot view this card as a 3-drop. It is not a 3-drop.
Yeah, it's a reactive card.
Yeah, it's a reactive card.
You definitely play a late game.
Yeah. I would probably play this as like a 5-drop.
I would play this
with bolster. You want to play it with bolster.
I would play it.
You need
like
to play this with bolster.
I definitely play this as a one of.
Yeah.
In that sort of deck, and I would run like all taunts with bolster.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Two bolsters. You can use one bolster when you have board control to just like solidify your board board position, or you can use one to combo with this like against aggro decks.
Yeah.
Because this basically like if you do Protect the King bolster, you like catch up. You pretty much catch up on the board if they don't have AoE, and aggro decks don't have AoE.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where I see it, like having some sort of application. The problem is you have to draw specifically those two cards at the right time and have them have a lot of minions and have the mana to cast those spells.
Yeah.
So if you haven't lost by then, that's actually sort of a miracle.
Well, you are a warrior, so you are have sustainability with the war axe and the hero power.
Yeah. The build has to be really good though, but like because
this card is absolutely dead against control decks.
It's true too. Yeah.
Yeah.
You need to draw well. You need to draw well with that deck, but since you want to draw well, you need to make good use of Battle Rage, and you have to include cards like Raging Ghoul. It's counterintuitive. Yeah. So it's an awkward kind of deck that you're gonna build, but you need to somehow make it work.
I guess I sort of changed my opinion on it. I just looking at the card, I think it's terrible, but like in a vacuum, but it's I guess it has some practical applications with like
impactful.
Bolster's the most obvious synergy, but it's just I don't know. It's just it's too bad with Ravaging Ghoul, and it's too bad with a lot of warrior cards.
And
it's just not that great.
Well, I think you're viewing it incorrectly. You don't never play this with Ravaging Ghoul, of course.
Well, obviously
you both utility cards.
It's anti-synergy.
Yeah,
and having cards that don't that completely negate each other are bad if you put them into a deck unless they have like
And you're also playing in a meta where you have to kind of run Ravaging Ghoul too. It's just to stay alive.
Ravaging Ghoul is just a better version of this. If you don't play bolster and you're just playing this like by itself, then what it does is it trades into all their minions.
Yeah,
for each minion that they have, Ghoul does that instantly and also procs your own.
What if you're a knife juggler?
Yeah, that's no.
It's not as good as Unleash the Hammer.
Knife juggler is not a warrior card. No, it is not even nearly as good.
Yeah,
you never know unless you try.
I don't think it's good.
I tried it.
Taunt is so much worse.
I actually did try it.
Taunt is just so much worse
weird.
Than charge.
It's weird.
Especially when you don't have like Buzzard Unleash or you don't have Timberwolf.
Oh,
you don't
man.
Have, like, you don't
those
stuff like
old
that.
Days. The good old Hunter days.
Yeah. My verdict, this card is not great.
Yeah.
It's not terrible. Absolute trash tier. Yeah. Like Purifier tier. It's pretty bad.
Yeah.
It's not good, but I'm going to put my faith in this.
Put your faith in the light.
I want to put my faith in it too because I want to play a bolster warrior.
Yeah,
yeah. Because
I don't want to play. I want to play control warrior.
Yeah. No, I like bolster warrior.
Yeah.
I'm just gonna keep playing my fool's bane.
What a fool! All right, now we're finally at the neutrals. So the first card we're starting off is Arcane Anomaly. 1 mana, 2/1. Whenever you cast a spell, give this minion +1 health.
This card is bad.
I think it's bad.
It's mana worm. That's bad. It's just a bad mana worm.
Yeah.
I actually tried out this card.
Gaining 1 health is not great.
It's not great, but I just like to use it for the early game. I did try it out.
I've seen people play this card. It's done some work.
Yeah, it does some work.
It is a 1-drop, but there's a Babbling Book.
There is a Babbling Book. Yeah, I agree with that.
This is just a bad card.
Like this card, I did do some testing, like between Argent Squire and this card, which one would you play?
It's definitely a Temple.
But you don't want to run Argent Squire and Temple Mage.
It's definitely a Temple card.
No, I didn't run it in Temple Mage. I ran it in Rogue.
It's a 1-drop.
That makes sense. Yeah, backstab and
Dragon. Yeah, backstab and then and you prep and then you do some crazy stuff.
But then the thing is, gaining 1 health on a 2-attack minion is not snowballing.
Yeah, it becomes like a 2-7.
And if you top deck this late game, it's absolutely garbage.
Yeah.
So yeah,
I think it's a bad card.
It's
a bad card.
Yeah.
Bad card.
I say it's interesting.
Interesting, yeah. I think it's interesting in the sense that
it looks cool. It looks cool. Look at that card. It looks cool.
It has a cool name. Yeah. It has a cool picture.
It looks like Nocturne from League of Legends.
Yeah, it does look like Nocturne.
Yeah. If you love Nocturne, you love this card.
Yeah.
All right. Except it's bad, so you're gonna lose games. All right. So the next card we're gonna be talking about is Arcanosmith, which is a 4 mana 3/2, and it's a battle which seems terrible, but it's Battle Cry, summon a 0/5 minion with taunt. And so, the first thing that screams out to me is Bolster Warrior.
Yeah, I ran this in my Bolster deck too.
I've seen it in Bolster Warrior. I do not like it in Bolster Warrior.
I think it might be good in Reno Walk. Because it sort of provides
Interesting.
Sustain.
Yeah.
And like, yeah.
I think the best comparison is the Tauren, the Infested Tauren.
But this, the Infested Tauren doesn't have, this thing doesn't have death rattle.
No, but the reason it provides some kind of four drop taunt that sticks around.
The reason why people ran Infested Tauren wasn't because it was a four drop.
It was because of Nuzzoth.
They ran it because of Nuzzoth, and rattle. They needed some sort of taunt to come out of Nuzzoth. Yes. They have, they were pigeonholed into running such a shitty card.
Yeah.
This is, on the other hand, does not have that like synergy. It's just a battle cry. So it might be really good with Brand or something.
You can compare this card actually to Senshin.
Yeah, but
Senshin Shield Master has something like it's a 3/5.
They're both good in their own respects. I just don't respect this card. I only see it seeing use in specifically Bolster Warrior.
Yeah, it is.
And even then, it's not that crazy. Like,
so would you run this? You would run Senshin Shield Master over this 100%.
No, not necessarily actually, because splitting it into two bodies is actually relevant.
Well, no,
having a 3/2 and a 2/6 is like.
The problem is this: you can remove Arcanosmith with, say, like a slam or like.
But in those situations, it's worse. But then in other situations, it's way better because you're protecting your other bodies. You're creating a new minion that synergizes with Bolster, and then that 2/6 minion, like you're basically getting the 4-mana 2/6 taunt minion for Warrior.
Oh yeah,
Butthoof Brave. You're basically getting that card with Bolster. And splitting it into two minions is really good. It gives you more flexibility. It makes it less vulnerable to hard removal.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
I give you a little food for thought.
I think it's better than Zenden.
No, I give you food for thought. There's actually another class that you can actually go to, which
Shaman?
Is Shaman.
With Flame Tongue Totem,
no,
right?
No, not with only Flame Tongue Totem, but with Bloodlust.
Oh, yeah.
You, like, those minions, like, that 0/5 taunt, it sticks long enough where you can actually use Bloodlust.
It's interesting, but there are better 4-drops.
Yeah,
there is better
4-drops,
but it can fit into the Shaman deck. Like, it can fit.
There's too many good cards in Shaman for this to be run.
True.
So, yeah.
That's
it's
true.
Okay.
Yeah.
It might see use if ever Taunt Warrior ever does the thing.
However, it's, in general, a bad card.
Yeah. Bad, really bad in Arena, in my opinion.
Yep.
Yeah, it's just a 4-mana 3/2. Alright, so the next one we're talking about is going to be the 5-mana 4/4 Menagerie Warden, Menagerie Magician, and it has Battle Cry, give a random friendly beast, dragon, and murloc, +2/+2. Now, the effect in itself, like in a vacuum, is crazy if you actually have beast, even just a single beast, a single dragon, or a single murloc. If you have two or three, this card becomes insane.
Right.
Problem is, are you going to be running all those cards in one deck just so that you can synergize off of these menagerie decks? Like the other card, which the Zubat.
The Zubat type
effects.
You also have the Curator as well.
Yeah, and the Curator.
It's definitely a build around kind of card.
I would see it seeing use in like a card like a deck like Renolock, where you're going to be running a bunch of like tech cards. Like you're going to be running like the 6-mana 2/3 Murloc that does 2 damage to all minions, and then you have the you're going to be running like Kodo, and you're going to be running like. The bookworm.
Twilight Drake.
Twilight Drake. Yeah, so that's where this card sees the most play. But
would you want to play this card?
I would run
else?
The Curator, but not this, because the Curator draws you those cards. This just simply buffs them. Yeah.
So this is more of an aggressive
card. So it has
to
be
anything.
An aggressive card that also runs
card.
Those three cards. And for all those synergies to come together and mesh well, I just don't see it happening.
It's a little janky, but I can kind of see people
the effect
like,
is,
trying to play with this.
Yeah, the effect is strong enough that it, like, encourages people to play with it. If it's +1/+1, obviously no one will play it. But if it's +2/+2, that effect is really, really strong.
Yeah.
And if you have two of those minions active and it goes off, it's really, really good.
It's like a quartermaster, but it has 4/4 stats, and it's super janky. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And yeah, but to see in those Renolock decks or in those like one ofs where
weird
you're running a bunch of
decks or whatever.
If you're running those weird control decks where you're running one of those like one minion to synergize with the Curator. Like, you're not going to want the +2/+2 buff anyways. Like, it's not going to be that impactful anyways.
Yeah.
And you have to get it off at the exact right time. And if you want to, in order to get it off at the exact right time, you have to run multiple copies of those cards.
That's right.
The Curator, let's say you draw the, let's say you draw the 6-mana 2/3 Murloc. Let's say you draw that before you draw the Curator. That's fine. You still get to draw your Kodo and still get to draw your Twilight Drake. With this card, you have to have the card played on the board, living, and have you play this card and have it be good. And in those situations, it's not even that amazing. So I don't like this card.
You said it quite well.
Yeah, for like aggressive kind of effect, it's kind of slow.
This is not a control card.
Yeah.
This is definitely an aggressive card.
Yeah.
And this,
I can see it in like crazy aggressive decks that run Cold Light Oracles.
Maybe
Charge Murlocs.
Like, the only classes I can actually see this actually working is probably Paladin and Warlock.
Yeah.
The thing is, this would be interesting if it was a Murloc-only card and it was like a quartermaster for Murlocs.
Yeah.
Then
it
would be interesting.
All the Murlocs.
Buffed all your Murlocs permanently by +2/+2.
Yeah.
Then this card would be interesting.
But you gotta run dragons and beasts
too.
So
I don't like it.
Well, actually, you know that new the Paladin card, that one that the muster for dragons.
The muster for are the whelps dragons though?
Yeah, they are.
Yeah, those dragons.
The whelps are dragons. Yeah, okay. Yeah.
So, can kind of work in kind of some kind of tempo aggressive Paladin.
But you either run beasts and where are your beasts and merlocks?
You had the Vilefin Inquisitor for their merlocks.
Oh Vilefin.
Yeah, and then you run a Dire Wolf Alpha. Wolf Alpha. It's essentially you like run aggressive dragons. Deck.
This goes in the Paladin deck.
Yeah, it's essentially an aggressive deck.
It could see play.
I don't see it seeing play.
No, I don't see this specific 5-drop being played, but the other card, Zubat, might see play.
Yes.
It's because it's faster. It's cheap enough. Yeah, it's cheap enough, it's faster, so.
And if you get two often, it's pretty good.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like a shadow. It's like pre-nerf shadows on the buffs. That's even better. But it requires you to put bad cards in your deck.
Well, they could be good in conjunction because of these cards. Yeah. Now it's insane.
Yeah. But this, I don't think this card will see play. Yeah. And moving on, we have Netherspite Historian, which is a 2-mana 1/3, and the battle cry is, if you're holding a dragon, discover a dragon. And this...
I love this card.
Yeah, same. Yeah. These cards are the most healthy for the game in the sense that they provide... It buffs control decks for obvious reasons.
Oh, yeah.
And not only that, it gives them some way to deal with, other aggressive decks early game that isn't overpowered.
Because of its stats. It has 3 health as opposed to, like, 1 health for the novice engineer
and
or
it's
2
not,
health for the curator.
And it's super good against control decks because you can pick the late game dragon. You can pick Ysera. You can pick Nefarian.
Yes.
Yeah. And it's not that bad against aggressive decks.
And the pool of dragons is so limited that the chance of getting
so
a good dragon...
Yeah. And you can pick Chomo. Chomo's crazy with this, like, against aggressive
decks. Oh, man, if you're running a Zoth, you get 2 Chomos.
Yeah.
It's just nuts.
I really like this card.
Brand Bronzebeard?
Any dragon deck, any control style deck.
Very good point. No, this
synergizes
a
Brand Bronzebeard.
Brand is already a popular card in dragon decks because of the Battlecry synergies.
Yeah.
This makes it even better.
Ooh.
So, in any sort of dragon control deck, this would definitely see play. And
might even make Dragon Priest good.
Would it? No, that's the thing. See, Dragon Priest is a tempo-based deck.
Yeah.
This is not that strong of a tempo card.
It's
but
yeah, it's not gonna,
it could be in a slower Dragon Priest.
It might be used as a one-off in the aggressive decks just to refuel, and it's not that bad. It's better than missing your 2-drop.
Yeah. And you gotta view it as a loot hoarder in a way.
It's sort of the babbling book argument you're making early, except that this slightly has better stats, and you get to discover the dragon.
Yeah, and you can cater
it to, you can cater it to your archetypes for, like, whatever class you're facing. If you're facing an aggressive deck, you can pick a better dragon for that. You can picking a control deck. You can pick Ysera, Nefarian. So this has way more options, more versatility, and has better stat line. Mm-hmm. So, I really like this card. And it's going to be the 2-drop that Dragon Paladin needed. The monster curve is definitely going to be this into the Muster for Dragons, into the Twilight Guardian, into the Black and Corrupt.
What if it's a knife jug?
It actually has a curve now.
It can have a disgusting curve.
Yeah, it could have a disgusting curve. So, yeah. Definitely
next level
card.
Paladin.
Good card, good card.
We like this card. We all agree.
Yeah, I love this card.
Bad card.
Pantry.
Pantry Spider. 3-mana, 1/3. Battlecry summon a 1/3 spider. The upside is their beasts. The downside is their stats.
Yeah, their stats. You're not going to contest anything with this card. Even though you're summoning 2 1/3s.
No, doesn't even synergize with, say, Steward of Darkshire.
Yeah, this card is crazy in Wild.
With Hobgoblin.
Yeah, with Hobgoblin. Sure. Yeah, right. I forgot. I forgot that card actually existed. Yeah, I agree with that.
Oh, wait, no. It's not even better than Amp Master. No, it's not, because the Battle Cry doesn't work with the Hobgoblin.
No, but the first stage still works.
No.
Oh, so you're saying we have 3/5.
Oh, never mind. No. This is not good, because it's not like it's not giving you a 0-mana 1/3 that you can play immediately. So then... Hobgoblin only actually works with cards that you play. So this doesn't copy over. It's just summoned in a 3-mana 1/3 Pantry Spider. So it's actually worse than the slime.
Yeah, it is.
Would you play this over the what do you call that? The Rage of Hand Hunter.
Yeah, well, Rage of Hand Hunter is just a bad card.
But it's still in Arena. It's kind of like a decent 3-drop.
In Arena, this is actually not too bad. Because it's a 3-mana 1/3, and you have 2 hobbies, so you have 2 power to contest.
3-mana 1/3s are not good.
They're not good, but you got 2 of them. That's the thing.
It's a 2-mana. So that's a 3-mana 2/6.
Would you rather have a 2/4?
And you have the flexibility.
A single 2/4 is better than 2-1/3.
Yeah, of course. So. Oh, not of course. There are situations.
Yes, of course.
But the 3-mana 1/3 give you more flexibility to deal the 1 damage where you need to deal the 1 damage.
Yeah.
Say against a Muster for Battle.
Yeah. So this is like the Muster for Battle counter. Why wasn't this in GVG? That's the real question. So I don't know. I don't like this card.
It's for Wild.
I don't like this card either, but hey, whatever.
It might see play. Not really.
In Reno, it is a beast, too.
Reno Hunter.
Beast Druid.
Watch out for this in Reno Hunter.
Reno Hunter.
Beast Druid. All right, so the next card is 2-mana 3/2. Pompous Thespian, and it just has Taunt. Bad card. Bad card?
You know,
bad card. Yeah, There's nothing else to say about it.
It is. It's just a power creep of the Frostwolf. Frostwolf.
It's like, not even as good as the Warrior one, the sparring partner.
Well, that gives it to someone else, yeah.
This is just not creative. I don't know why they made this card.
This is just, it's just an arena card. It's not a bad arena card.
Yeah, it's not bad.
And it's terrible and constructed.
Yeah.
Simple as that.
All right.
Not a creative card.
Bolster.
Runic Egg.
Runic Egg.
Somewhat creative. I don't like this card.
I don't like this card.
It sucks.
It's a lot worse than Dragon Egg.
Yeah.
Because it doesn't... Drawing a card when it dies is a lot worse than every time it takes damage, give you a 2-1.
Mm-hmm.
So this standardizes a lot worse with buffs. I don't like this card.
Mm-hmm. This is not going in control decks
either. And it doesn't...
Drawing cards is good, but not when it's a 1-mana 0/2.
And it's not a dragon. So...
Yeah.
It's not a dragon.
Is Dragon Egg a dragon?
No, Dragon Egg is not a dragon,
but the
Whelps dragons?
Whelps are dragons.
I guess the Whelps being dragons aren't really relevant.
Yeah, it's not relevant.
But
kind of based with Zubat.
But then not being dragons is even worse.
Yeah, it's true.
Yeah, so this card is just
bad.
Not good.
Bad. I don't like it. A lot of people are like, oh yeah, this card's not that bad in Zoo. No, it's pretty bad in Zoo.
Yeah, because Zoo, you need minions, and you have a lifetime.
You'd rather have an Argent Squire.
Yeah.
Yeah.
People were like, oh, Runic Egg is so good with Abuse of Argent. I'm like, so is Argent Squire, and so is
So is Dragon Egg.
Yeah, so is Dragon Egg.
There you go.
Yeah. Alright, so yeah. Bad card.
Bad card.
Yeah. Violent Illusionist. This is the card. This is the Fool's Bane card. 3 mana, 4/3. During your turn, your hero is immune. This card is... has a really crazy effect, but
I wouldn't say it's insane.
No, it has... The effect is super good and super unique. The problem is, you don't want to run a 3-mana 4/3 in that type of deck. You don't want to run a 3-mana 4/3 in a control warrior. It's not heavy enough. It doesn't provide enough individual value.
It dies the turn after.
And it has a very niche, specific use. And that use might... the benefit that you gauge out of it in the best scenario possible... First of all, the best scenario possible where you're hitting 4 mains on the same turn where you're playing this is very low. And even in that situation, it's not that crazy. And it doesn't really warrant you running a 3-mana 4/3 in your deck. Mm-hmm. So I don't like this card.
I personally do like this card just because I do play Rogue a lot.
Rogue, because
Rogue does not have sustain anymore. And they take a lot of damage just from the weapon itself. Like, we lost Healbot, and we don't even run Farseer anymore. But this might actually change it a little bit, but who knows.
It's still just a 3-mana 4/3, and the 3 slots are already clogged in Rogue.
I've actually lost even... Like, when I first saw this card, I thought it was, like, okay. And then when I looked at it, it's during your turn. It's not permanent. It's not, like, Mal'Ganis effect. It's terrible.
You can't even stealth it and expect to live through the next turn if you're dying.
Yeah, I don't like it.
Feels bad, man.
At least it's not battle cry for the turn that you play it. It's during your turn for every turn thereafter.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So just for negating weapon damage.
And fatigue damage.
But like I said, in those sorts of decks where you're trying to get to fatigue, where you're trying to save life from your from using weapons on minions, you don't want to play a 3-mana 4/3. Except maybe in Rogue, and even Rogue is just a... It's already been established that it's not a good tempo deck. You have to run some sort of miracle combo.
Yep.
So, yeah. Not a very good card.
What does he play in Reno Lock, where you tap a lot?
You're only going to be tapping once. At most, if this is a 3-mana 4/3, restore 2 health to only your hero if you can tap, which is bad. Not that good.
Yeah.
True.
Maybe it'll see use with Cho'Gall. You can play this.
Oh, yeah. That's,
maybe you can do Cho'Gall, Violet Illusionist, synergy. And then you
turn,
can play...
Turn 10 play.
And then you can play some ridiculous spell.
Yeah, you play Doom and not take any damage.
Yeah, yeah, and then spend your entire turn doing just
Jackal.
Jackal.
Bad card. Moving on. Then we have Menagerie Magician Jr., which is Zubat, 3-mana 3/3. Give a random friendly beast, dragon, and Murloc +1/+1.
And it's a mech.
Damn.
Ooh.
Which is not very relevant.
Yeah, it's not relevant because we don't have any mechs anymore. Unless you want to play Gorilla.
This is good in a specific deck, but someone will have to find the right build.
I think it belongs to that Paladin deck
we mentioned earlier. Potentially Zoo as well.
Yeah, but Zoo doesn't have the synergies that allow for, say, like, that Murloc.
If you think about
Murloc
the
cards,
did
dragons.
You remember how good Zoo, like, Warlock,
the original
Murloc Warlock was great, but
that was when Blood Imp was insane.
Oh, wait, that's also because Murkai was insane, too.
Yes.
But that's gone.
If you think about the beast that you can play, what are the beasts you can play in
Direwolf Alpha?
There's only Direwolf Alpha, really.
And then how about the dragons? There's not much. There's the Whelps from Dragon Egg.
True.
Right? And then there's the Murloc, which is the Colite Oracle.
Yeah.
That's
so
pretty much
really
it. And the Biofin Titan.
Really
yeah,
just
Biofin, yeah.
Paladin with that new 3-drop to summon the 2-1.
We have to see, and I'm still not even sure if the Whelps are dragons.
They are.
Yeah. For sure.
They show.
Welsh
they
specifically respond. I mean, refers to dragons.
Okay. So if the Welsh are dragons, then yeah, this could see play. But I don't know.
Well, you can just ignore the dragons completely and just let it hit beasts and murlocs.
Yeah. Even in an aggressive deck, when you hit beasts and murlocs in an aggressive deck, it's pretty good.
Three mana, 4/4. Why not?
Three mana, 5/5, and +2/+2 of the murder.
It's like Shattered Sun Cleric.
Except it's like +1 health. It's a mech, and it buffs 2 things.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Up to 3 things.
Mm-hmm. So this could be absolutely insane
in that decks. Really tacked out aggressive deck that has specifically those like Direwolf Alpha, the murloc, the dragon, the whelp generators, and the Coalite Oracle.
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah, you could run some sort of like Divine Favor Coalite Oracle deck.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Along with the Valfins, and then you have a hero power.
And you have a lot of cheap minions, and you buff them up. Actually, yeah, I sort of like this.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty good.
It's cheap enough to be used.
I like its effectiveness. I don't like how it forces card.
Yeah, it forces you to take a really really unique style into deck building.
Yeah, but yeah.
And it also pigeonholes you into playing aggro since it's an aggro card. You're not gonna play this in a deck. Yeah. So good in Murloc, Beast, Dragon, Paladin, Aggro, and not very good in anything else.
Who knows? Someone might find something.
Someone might find something.
I just thought of Paladin because they have the tools to work with.
Yeah. Mm. All right. So, okay card.
Yeah, okay card.
Next one, 12 mana, Arcane Giant. Costs 1 less for each spell you've cast this game, and of course it's an 8/8 because it's a giant. I have no clue how to evaluate this card.
You don't?
I think it's...
I thought this card is strong.
A lot of you said it's strong, but you need to cast so many spells to make it cheap.
I know, but if you're playing like a Yaw kind of mage, what can you lose? Like, you can play this for pretty cheap later in the game.
The problem is this. It's sort of like the.
It's like Frost Giants.
No. It's sort of like the totem card for Shaman. It's the Thing from Below. I would compare it to that.
Because Thing from Below.
Thing from Below is cost 1 less for each totem you've played. Like you've summoned this.
And
game.
It starts at 6 mana.
Yeah, and it starts at 6 mana. This starts at 12 and it's 8/8. It doesn't have taunt.
Yeah, it's an okay card, I'd say. It definitely isn't an aggressive card, maybe a more mid rangey or control-y card.
It's definitely a control card because mid range decks won't have enough spells and won't have enough time to support playing this card. It's okay. It's pretty good in control type decks. The problem is it doesn't really do anything that they're currently like it doesn't really help their weaknesses.
You think it might help out rogues? Just another threat?
Maybe.
I don't think rogues, they generate rogues enough play a lot spell of, to actually
they do play a lot of spells.
They do, but...
It's such a bad draw early. That's the thing. It gives you another possibility to draw poorly.
That is true.
Yeah.
I think one of the decks that can use this quite effectively is probably Yogg-Druid.
Yogg-Druid?
Yeah, for they can even intervene. Or
really
out
any,
if they
just,
want
just
to.
Any Yogg deck in general.
Yeah.
Right, so you can place alongside, say, like spamming the board full of like throw down an Arcane Giant as well.
This might be a one of.
It's kind of like a Sea Giant for that kind of deck. Yeah.
This is like a one of in a Yogg-Druid.
One of.
People would experiment with this first as a one of, and if it turns out to be bad, then they won't play it. And if it becomes good, they can try two copies. And then the deck might start building towards that specific
giant.
It's the next Molten Giant. Yeah.
It's definitely not like broken. It's not like that powerful.
People might even run Sun Fury because of this. They go like Arcane Sun Fury. it's like the old Molten Sun Fury. Except that it doesn't even
look like... In those decks, you would rather run something like Frost Giant. It's like a lot more...
Well, see, the thing is, Frost Giant, you can only cast
with your hero
one
powers.
Of them every turn, and you have the hero power, which is not something you want to do early, or early to mid-game. And then with this card, with a deck like Yogg-Druid or Yogg-Mage, you're going to be casting spells every single turn, all the way up until Yogg, or up until you play this. So it's often you're going to play it for like 3 or 4 mana.
True.
Especially in the mid-late game. And you're going to play... Stuff like Wild Growth. Wild Growth counts for 2 mana cost reduction for this. So this is the more I think about it, it's actually really crazy in Yogg-Druid.
Yeah, it could be.
Yeah,
especially
it's
after
crazy in Yogg-Druid.
Basically after turn 10, this thing will cost close to 0 mana.
But the problem is drawing it early. It's not.
You don't want to draw it early, but it's crazy if you draw it later because it's basically 0 mana 8/8 that you can tempo with the rest of your cards. And it's good with Nourish because Nourish draws your cards and this builds with this synergizes with your card advantage. And allows you to convert your card advantage to tempo.
Absolutely.
In a really, really massive way because it's an 8/8. Especially if you play 2 of these.
You're talking about drawing cards and slamming them all down.
Yeah.
Alright, cool.
The more I talk about this card, the more I think it's good.
I'm still not convinced, though.
It's good because...
I think it's too fringy.
It's good because it's cost 1 less spell for each spell you've cast this game. Not each spell that you've cast like since you've drawn the card. Mm-hmm. So that's what makes it better. Is because like once you draw it, it will be 0 mana in the late game. For sure. And the moment you did, and 8/8, like the stat line, like the 0 mana 8/8 stat line is such a ridiculous board swing.
Oh yeah,
that just that by itself would justify.
That's why they nerfed Molten Giant.
Yeah, which is which is why this might actually.
This is
be just
the Molten Giant
for Yagdrin.
Next one, yeah.
Yeah, except it doesn't even require them to damage you. They can't even play around it.
Yeah,
you just
you feel even
it's
better.
It's up to you casting spells.
Yeah, you feel even better. Yeah.
Yeah, I like this card. Next one, Barnes. This is the one of the most exciting minions.
This is the most spoken about card.
Yeah.
It's wonky, man.
This is the Maligos card. It's the Auctioneer card. It's the Emperor Thorason card.
It's a Ragnaros card. Ragnaros, the Sylvanas card.
Tyrion. This card is crazy. It's specifically Nazoth Paladin, I think.
Or just in control decks in general that pack super like relevant cards.
But you have to have a lot of Death Rattles or Emperor. Or
like just on the board effects.
So there's Cairn. There's Sylvanas.
Ysera.
I think this will have obviously this will have the most impact in Nazoth Paladin because pretty much every card except for other than like Acolyte, I guess, and like
Pyromancer,
the Justicar. There's I'd say like 2/3 of the cards in that deck, the 2/3 of the minions are relevant and are massively impactful for a 4-drop. Like, even when it's a 4-mana 3/4 and a 1/1, it's not absolutely terrible.
No, not at all.
And then when you get a Reg, like Fire Lord or Light Lord, it's freaking crazy. You get Tyrion, you just win the game off the like.
It synergizes with Steward of Darkshire, so whatever this thing summons has a Divine Shield.
Yeah, and it synergizes, and you get Sylvanas or Cairn, you also win the game early.
Yeah.
It gets crazy. And not only that, but it also gives Nazoth an extra Death Rattle. So let's say you get Cairn, you get an extra Cairn to be sticky for the board. So this card is really, really good.
Anyway, if you have Brandon on the previous turn and it survives.
Oh my god. You can get two Reg Fire Lords.
It's absolutely disgusting.
That's disgusting. Yeah. Oh my god.
But it can also whiff and give you... I don't know, anything.
The thing is, when it whiffs, it's not that bad.
It's not even that bad.
It's like a Yeti split into two bodies.
Yeah.
Which isn't amazing, but for the running, it's like Tusk Archotamics.
Yeah,
it's like
you have the chance of just getting something great.
It's like a suboptimal, it's like not amazing, but the reason you run it is because it has the synergy. Like for Tusk Archotamics, is the totems, and you have a chance to just win the game with the totem golem. That it's so good that it's not, you cannot run this card.
Mm-hmm. I agree with that.
Although the only card that like stands out to me, like the only deck archetype that fits into that stands out to me right now is the Nazoth Paladin, which is not that strong right now. But I don't know. It might be good in specifically combo decks which run only a few minions. It might see use in the Mali Ghost Hunter or the Yogg Hunter, where you're only running specific cards. They actually took out the cloaked in favor of the cloaked huntresses. They took out the King's Alec because it dilutes the consistency of always drawing Emperor Thorason or always drawing Yogg Saron.
Oh, so you can just target.
So you
Emperor,
can target
Tarsen,
your Emperor
Maligos.
Yeah, Maligos. You put Maligos into the deck and then specifically draw. Even if you have cloaked huntress. Then this is basically just a 4-mana cloaked huntress that's a Yeti.
Oh yeah,
that's
pretty. You play all the secrets.
Then you just dump all your secrets. So it's basically like a third cloaked huntress in that situation. That thins your deck. That's pretty good, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, the card is so flexible.
This is good. Yeah, this card is flexible. Like it's good in a multitude of archetypes.
Yeah.
And it's really, really strong in specific ones.
The question is, are we going to grow to hate this card?
Yeah, it's also because it's also another massive RNG element. It's like it's you hate it or you don't hate it. And when you get Tyrion,
when your opponent gets something amazing and you don't.
When you get Tyrion, this is just so stupid. Like, how are you supposed to deal with that? How are you supposed to deal with the 1-mana 1/1 taunt with Divine Shield that summons an Ashbringer?
You don't.
Yeah, don't. Or you get Sylvanas off of this, and that means that there's Nazoth summons 2 Sylvanases.
Yeah.
God.
Yeah. Oh man, I don't know if I'm looking forward to this.
Oh man, if Tyrion actually comes I'll be so tilted. Obviously. Holy.
You get the Moat Lurker. Gosh. Coin it out the next turn.
Ooh,
oh, the Moat Lurker. Oh my.
We can talk about that later.
Yeah, we'll talk about that later. But great card and potentially extremely frustrating.
Yeah.
Next one. Oh yeah, we're gonna keep talking about the exciting cards of the set. Medivh the Guardian, 8-mana 7/7 battle cry. Equip Atiush, Great Staff of the Guardian. So a lot of people think this card is overrated. What do you think?
It's overrated.
It's overrated. I think this card is pretty average itself.
The card itself, when you play
it, you don't think it's average, or
it doesn't. It's 8-mana 7/7.
I think this card is average in power level in a vacuum. But the thing with this card is, it's actually not as easy to deal with as you think it is, because you have to have specifically weapon removal, and you have to have an
true
answer for the same.
That's true.
So it doesn't affect the board the turn you play it. But the fact that you have Atiush means, like, let's say the next turn you cast any large spell, it's ridiculous.
Yeah.
They can't, for summoning, like, if you're playing Summoning Stone mm-hmm. actually saw a little bit of play at DreamHack Austin when Tars brought it.
Mm-hmm.
And it was the highlight of the entire tournament, because he went, like, he made top 8, and then he made it to the top 16 playoffs. So he was top 8 in Swiss, and he made it to the top 16.
With the Summoning Stone.
With the Summoning Stone Yogg Druid. And yeah, and basically everyone was praising, oh, this guy's like the number one deck builder. This is basically Summoning Stone, except it's more consistent because they have to have specifically weapon removal, and they have to have both weapon removal and an answer to your 7-7.
But here's the thing, it's 8 mana 7-7. It's a slow card. You it really have card. To not be dying by the time you
but
play this card.
But the great thing about this card is if you survive, then you basically win the game if you cast any large spell. And especially any spell that gives you tempo.
Would you say it's a win more card? It's not going to bring you back.
It's a catch-up card.
It's not going to bring you back from behind.
It is going to catch up.
Because what you can do is you can play like a spell. You can play
What kind of spell?
Lay on Hands. Let's say you play this in a Paladin deck.
Okay.
You play Lay on Hands. Restores 8 health. Normally, Lay on Hands is such a tempo loss. You're only playing Lay on Hands when you have to dig for an answer.
Right.
And the health helps you stall for you to look for that. Like,
but think of this.
This just gives you the minion on that turn. Let's say you get Rag Lightlord. Then it's a 16 health swing.
But think about it this way. You're running this card and Lay on Hands. Are you cutting Tyrion and Ragnaros?
No, you can also get Lay on Hands from like Ivory Knight or something.
It's so conditional.
No, let's not like, even.
It's
think
not
about...
conditional though because
it is.
You can choose to play a low cost spell.
The main problem I have is it's a late game card. It's 8 mana 7-7. It doesn't impact the board immediately. It's too slow, and you're cutting out other great late game cards for it.
Is this worse than other late game cards though?
Yes.
It's not though because it's sticky.
You would
it's
not
sticky in the
play
sense
this.
That...
You would not play this over Ragnaros.
It's a yeah. You
or
would
Tyrion.
You wouldn't. But not only Paladin. First of all, only Paladin can play Tyrion. And second of all, this card has like a surprise element to it too, and it also gives you it gives you an effect that's unique in the sense that it generates tempo and value. It's not actually a win more card because it is a win more card, but it also gives you the ability to come back if you play pure tempo spells that cost a lot of mana.
But your deck has to have those spells.
If you're playing like let's say you're playing Warlock, okay, and you play Twisting Other with this. This is after you cast a spell. Atiesh is after you cast a spell. So you play Twisting Nether.
So wait, really?
It removes all the minions.
Then you summon
an 8-drop. That's ridiculous.
That's cool.
Yeah. So it's specifically with Twisting Nether has a really good synergy. But specifically with Lay on Hands is a really good synergy. Any high cost spell you should be any specifically 8-cost minions are like the swing minions.
Yeah, they're the swing minions.
We get the rags. And the Tyrion. But, like, the other mana cost is not that bad because you're still getting a minion and the minion can attack next turn to help contest the board. And if you're playing a spell that gives you tempo back or gives you health back, then you're catching back up.
All of this is assuming that you are not totally dead or screwed.
But you can say that about any card, though. Like, you say, why would you even play Sylvanas?
Because cards
you can just ignore Sylvanas and just go face.
It's early enough
this
that,
card is,
that you can actually have some impact with it. This is 8 mana.
You see this about... The effect
not
is
only that,
so
okay.
strong that it might warrant inclusion.
Consider this. There's a Fool's Bane here, and it's going to be in most of the control warriors.
It's
because of that card, and say the meta right now, which
might actually slow down.
People will run Harrison and Ooze, thus creating an environment where this card is going to be hit by.
Yeah, so it really depending
as well.
On how frequent weapon removal and weapon hate is going to be common in the meta.
Yeah.
If it is common, obviously this card is not that great because then they'll consistently be able to remove. Your Atiesh.
Yeah.
The thing with this card is that I don't think it's gonna be in like net deck lists. It's not gonna be included.
It's gonna be included.
Basically, at, like the highest legend ranks, people are gonna like run this like a secret tech, and then when people run up against it, they're not gonna know how to deal with it.
Right.
And they're not gonna be able to deal with it because it's such a crazy board swing. And if you let either iteration live, it's crazy. Even an 8 mana 7-7 is impactful enough to sort of affect the board. With the Atiesh, and you're playing a high tempo spell that costs a lot of mana, you're going to be instantly winning the game.
I don't know about that. Ronin doesn't ever see play.
Well, the difference with Ronin is you're getting arcane missiles, and you have to cast them. And
it's a death rattle.
Yeah,
this
and,
is a battle cry.
A battle cry. And the next turn, if you have a spell in hand and you cast it, you get both the spell's effect and the minion that you get off of it. And for specifically 8-drop spells, and the 8-drop minions you get out of it are really, really crazy.
So what decks do you think this goes in? You mentioned Paladin, but what else? Like Warlock.
Warlock would have to have
I'd say,
a really specific...
I'd say most importantly it goes in Mage because of
Flame
Strike.
Yeah, it goes in Mage quite well.
Do a lot of damage, get a 7-drop.
I'd say this might spawn a Yogg Hunter.
That's interesting.
Because Call of the Wild is ridiculous.
Imagine summoning
Rag, either Rags or Tyrion with Call of the Wild.
Yeah.
That's absolutely absurd.
That is. What if you get Anomalous, though?
Yeah, then you'd be a little bit sad.
Yeah.
But that's just a fringe scenario. Yeah. That being said, I like this card. I just don't think it'll be very viable.
I think it's interesting. I don't think it's going to be viable, but I wouldn't discount it that quickly. A lot of people just said, oh, this card is too slow. Yeah.
I think it's too slow.
I think this card has potential.
It does.
For sure.
It does.
Just because the effect is so strong, and it's unique in the sense that the weapon, the effect is in the weapon, not the minion. So if they destroy the minion, it's still active. They have to have specifically weapon removal. They have to have weapon removal in their deck, and they have to draw it by the time you play this, which is, assuming if they're running one copy, there's like a 50 to 60% chance that they'll draw it by the time you play this if you play it on curve. So they have to have both those answers. And a lot of decks don't run weapon removal, so.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Even against aggro decks, this might be good because when you
I disagree.
When you play
okay, that's a big
because against aggro decks, what you can do like aggro mid range, what you can do is you can play this card and then they don't deal with it. You play something like Forbidden Healing, and then you get the I guess with Forbidden Healing it doesn't work because Forbidden Healing technically costs zero mana.
Yeah, yeah.
Does it summon at zero cost or does it?
Yeah, summon at zero cost.
It's a zero cost.
With Lay on Hands, specifically Lay on Hands, or you do it with Twisting Nether. Then you basically just completely gain tempo back, and then the RTS will give you back like board initiative.
Mm-hmm.
So it's still not that bad, because you're committing all the tempo aspect of it, like the tempo gain and the life gain in the spell, and you're getting the minion back, which might also be Reg Light Lord, which will give you even more health.
You're really making a lot of assumptions in your hope.
Yeah, I am making a lot of assumptions, but then
most of the time I say that it's just
these are not assumptions. I'm just exploring the possibilities.
You just like this card.
I do like this card.
Yeah.
I
like the card too, but I immediately discredit it.
I don't think it's going to be that good.
Did you know I bought Medivh for this card?
Does you it have
roleplay Medivh? Yeah, I need roleplay Medivh to play Medivh. Yeah, exactly.
Is it like an interaction?
I don't know. That's what I'm hoping.
It has to be.
They're missing out on opportunity.
Yeah, I know.
I'm
hoping there's interaction. If there's none, I'm disappointed.
At the least, interesting card. It's the first ever spell weapon, so...
I've always hoped they made something like
a wand or a staff or something.
I was hoping they'd make a weapon with spell power that lost durability every time you
I don't think that's even that good, though.
It would be good, because
it depends on how much spell power it
has. It's sticky spell power.
It depends on, like, the numbers there. Like,
plus
if it's
one.
Just plus one.
But with a lot of durability.
With how much durability?
Like three or four.
And, like, how much mana cost?
Three mana, one, three?
Three like mana, one, three. That would be pretty bad.
I think it's...
That'd be garbage.
It'd be a setup card. Instead of needing like to play Blood Mage Donalds or something, you would equip it one turn, and then the next turn you'd go face
Blood
spells.
I think 1 mana, 1/3 weapon with one plus one spell power.
That's too strong.
No,
that's too strong.
That's
trust me.
That's pretty strong.
You're underestimating spell power.
Yeah, but if it's plus one spell power, it's not that crazy. And you only get 3 uses out of it. Then, by your logic, that means the 2 mana 3/2 with plus one spell power is absolutely ridiculous.
It's not.
Yeah, it's
because
not.
Because it's not sticky.
Yeah, it's not sticky.
But the
weapons are in general are sticky.
But a 2 mana 3/2 minion is often pushes damage. It's a threat. The 1 mana 1/3 weapon.
We're
is
speaking
not
of different archetypes.
And it's weak to weapons.
Imagine you run a lot of AoE.
If you run around a lot of AoE, but plus one spell damage, if you're running heavy AoE, it's not going to be relevant.
It's good.
If you run elemental destruction, it's not relevant. Plus one spell power is not relevant.
It is.
It is
well, not elemental destruction.
It is if you're running lightning.
But if you're thinking about lightning storm or maelstrom.
If it's all the like low damage spells that cost low like a small amount of mana, then it's
even consecration benefits greatly from spell power.
Yeah, I like this card.
All right, so back to Medivh.
It's a cool card. Yeah.
It's a cool card. I don't think it's viable.
It's a cool card.
You think it has hope?
I definitely think it has.
I hope it has. I hope it has.
I think people would start to run this card like.
It's good in Yogg-Hunt, right?
This is what I predict. People will run this card, trying to make it work, and get smashed.
No, my prediction is people will not run this card because they're listening to all the reviewers who are saying that it's overrated.
I'm not even listening to other reviewers.
And I think it's underrated.
All right.
But you're a reviewer.
I think the people who say it's overrated is underrated. I'm like on the next step. I'm on the next step here.
You're a step above.
Yeah, basically.
All right.
Garbage card.
No, Moros. Actually.
3 mana, 1/1 stealth. At the end of your turn, summon a 1/1 steward. If you're comparing this to Imp Master, it's absolutely garbage.
At first.
No, at first.
At first, I immediately dismissed it.
I thought it was bad. And after analyzing it and people saying it was... it's like a paladin
worse.
Hero power that
it's
you get every
worse.
Turn. I still think it's bad. It's even worse than I thought
it's
it was.
It's good with Steward of Darkshire.
No, it's absolutely terrible.
No. You know what it's good
not,
with? I'll
no,
tell you what it's good with.
Absolutely terrible.
I'll tell you what it's good. Young Priestess.
You love that card.
Absolute garbage. Not only does it get hard countered by Ravaging Ghoul and any sort of AoE and the Maelstrom Portal that's gonna just come out, you just compare it to Imp Master. It's so bad compared to Imp Master.
What if
it's
you gave it Divine
online.
Shield?
If you gave it Divine Shield, you have to be running Steward of Darkshire. Steward of Darkshire is an aggressive card. This is not an aggressive card.
It could be. It sustains 1/1s. It keeps giving you the ammunition with Divine Shield. It keeps giving you 1/1s every turn.
You have to coin the 3-mana, if you want to get this early.
Well, early, but no, this is more
the Darkshire, which is a 3/3, and have to have it live. And then you play the 3-mana. Right. And then you play this, which is a 3-mana 1/1 that summons a 1/1, which is so much worse than Imaster.
The only way I guarantee to actually use it in the early game is just Young Priestess. Believe it or not, it did play around swipe and it did get rolling, and I did steamroll a lot of like druid decks that,
because
or
you
even
got
warriors. Yeah, just because they can't remove it, because it kept buffing it. But that's one of the only ways I can actually play this early. So that's also an interesting fact.
It's not a powerful card at all.
Yeah, it's not a powerful card. I agree, it's not powerful at all, but it's very unique.
It's unique.
It's one of the few cards that has stealth and it has a consistent effect going on.
It's a cute card.
Yeah,
it's cute. Yeah, like
it's a style card.
It's a style card.
Some people were
people with style.
Some people were saying, "Oh, this is a value card because you get a paladin hero power every turn." I'm like, "Yeah,
it is a value card."
I bet you
ravaging ghoul.
Is it good?
You
though?
Instantly lose the game because you're losing.
But what if you're not playing against warrior?
Well, you are, because warrior is a class, and warrior is the most popular class.
When I play against warrior,
what if you check it and you ban warrior?
Nope.
Then you're winning.
I mean, I'm talking about ladder ranked mode. You know, a lot of cards that are really, really bad on ladder are used in tournaments. Like, the first thing that comes to mind is Sogoth the Slither.
Oh, yeah.
That was a card that was, like, it doesn't make any sense at all, but it's really good specifically in tournaments. It targeted Rogue back when Rogue was popular.
You can't deal with that.
You just cannot deal with a 5-9 that can't be targeted with
It's
spells.
Like I'm punching a dagger, but it hurts. It burns.
You gotta use your Leeroy on it. Power overwhelming.
So, bad card is my final verdict for this. Just bad. Really bad.
I'm gonna have to agree. It's a bad card, but I like it.
You have the same feeling. Yeah,
but it's kind of the opposite with the
Medivh and Morozov.
I like Medivh, but I just think it's too damn slow. Yeah. This can be worked with because it's cheap.
This is a 3-mana 1/1.
Yeah, although I did run it, it's a card that relies on a lot of conditions to be played. Like you need something else to play.
It's also one of, so it's
it's also one of.
You're really not like banking on this card winning games for you.
Moving on, we have Prince Malkazar, and it's a 5-mana 5/6, so Pit Fighter stats, vanilla stats.
It's a
when
demon.
The game start, yeah, it's a demon. When the game starts, add 5 extra legendary minions to your deck. So no, there never has been an ability like this in Hearthstone.
No,
where
that's never.
It happens at like the beginning of the game, like guaranteed.
So your deck is already automatically
sets at
worse.
35. Yeah.
This deck, I mean, this card is just bad. In Arena, I think it's actually really good in Arena, because in Arena it increases your card quality, because most legendaries are like fat minions, and in Arena you just want fat minions that have some really dumb effect, swings the board, or just does something really, really stupid. You don't want that in Constructed. In Constructed, you want a consistent deck list where you know the cards that you're gonna draw. If you draw random legendaries, most of the times they're not gonna help with your game plan.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So this card is just bad.
It's true.
It dilutes. You're not gonna.
It
run
dilutes
a pit fighter.
Your deck.
You're not running a pit fighter, and the pit fighter. This is a pit fighter with a downside in Constructed. The only thing I see this being played in is like some sort of fatigue deck, maybe.
Grinder, I can see this grinder. Being teched like it's... in a previous argument in tournament decks.
Yeah, in tournament decks that target like fatigue decks, pure fatigue.
Yeah, pure fatigue. Yeah.
Other than that, there's no really other application for it. Like, it's just a bad card in a vacuum, and it's a huge noob trap.
It definitely is. Yeah.
Like people will run this in like mid range decks and get absolutely punished, or not absolutely punished, because they'll get like a dragon and like red black hand. To kill your legendary. Because that's what happens whenever I play Elise Mirrors.
But in most applications, it's not.
This card is just bad.
Yeah.
So, yeah, at least we can agree on this one. This card's bad. Next card is the Curator, which is the last of the zoo type cards with
the Zubat Menagerie type.
Zubat. Menagerie Magician, Zubat, and Curator. 7-mana 4/6 Taunt. Yeah, the Taunt is actually pretty relevant. Battlecry, draw a beast, dragon, and Murloc from your deck, and it's a mech. Which is not very important, but still it's there.
So straight up, its stats are garbage, but it draws you 3 cards. So that's
ridiculous.
That's comparable to the old Ancient of Lore.
Ancient of Lore was one of the best cards that was like ever.
Yeah.
And you can't really say this stat that the stats are garbage for what the effect does. And this, in addition, this thing has taunt.
Yeah. Plus, it draws you a third card.
That being
said, you're really catering towards. You're really building around this card.
I think this card is very good in Arena Lock. Because you can run that 6-mana 2/3, you can run the Murloc.
Yeah, but
AoE.
It's currently not even played, so
you can run it just because of this. You can run your Twilight Drake. You already have your dragons, and you can run your Murloc, which is like the Wait, what Murloc would you even use with this? I guess you don't even need it.
I guess only Murloc is a Borg
Murloc,
clear Murloc.
The Murloc with a Borg clear Murloc.
Yeah, Borg clear.
I already covered the Murloc, actually. Yeah. And then the beast is Kodo. So this card is amazing. This card is Ancient of Lore with Taunt that has better, has an arguably better stat line, and it draws you an extra card. And it draws you cards that you know you're going to draw. Yeah. That's crazy.
Yeah. What I thought about this card is you can use it in certain combo decks to get the combo pieces that you want.
Right, but the thing is, what are the Murlocs and Dragon the Beast are
combo pieces? like Malagos oh, yeah, or something like that. Yeah, there's possibilities of doing that. But...
In that case, like if all you're drawing is Malagos and the stats for this is kind of garbage.
No, it's not though.
You'd rather run something with better like Taunt and Heal to stay until you finally draw Malagos.
The difference between this though is because, like, you know Ancient Harbinger, right? The 6 mana 4/6 that draws a 10-drop. This is, you get, if you're only running one dragon,
it doesn't have to survive.
This thing, it doesn't have to survive. Yeah, that's so paying one extra mana for Taunt and that effect, and to draw additional beasts and Murlocs to help you survive is a pretty big deal.
Fair enough.
Mm-hmm. It's a guarantee.
Guarantee. That effect, the consistency aspect, and paying one extra mana for that is really important.
So you only see this card in Reno decks that would be janky enough to include all these cards.
Definitely not in those aggressive decks that we're talking about earlier.
No, not at all.
Yeah.
Oh, that's too heavy.
But can you build a deck that's not a Reno deck that has these archetypes?
Well, you don't need to because there's already the Reno deck, like I said. I don't think you.
The issue with Reno is it's inconsistent in its draws. That's the biggest.
This card is the difference with Reno decks is the cards by themselves have enough power and are strong enough individually that they just carry the game, and then you have Reno to heal up.
Yeah. So, all right.
This card is really good.
Your thing is really good. I think it's okay.
I think it's pretty decent.
It's pretty good. Like it's not insane, but it's pretty good.
Main Offender being at 7 mana.
These people say Ancient of Lore, it's 7 mana. You can't draw 2 cards.
You play.
Yes, you can. And
Ancient
it's crazy.
Of Lore goes in a deck where you have strong mid game, so it's generally supported by Druid of the Claw and all that stuff.
Yeah, it's supported by whatever you're playing. You're supported by Kodo, supported by Twilight Drake. It thins your deck too.
You're hoping you have board when you play this.
This will be played in a Reno deck that's not Warlock because Warlock doesn't need any more card draw.
Mm-hmm.
So. It would probably be like Reno Mage
or Paladin.
Yeah,
or
Reno Paladin.
This is another card along with the Mage class cards released that might make Reno Mage viable.
Whew. All right.
I like it. And next one, so we're done with the legendaries. We have the Avian Watcher, which is a 5 mana 3/6 and Battlecry. If you control a secret, gain +1/+1 and Taunt. I like it.
Reno Mage. Right away.
This is the Reno Mage expansion.
Yeah,
there's so many mages that benefit Reno Mage.
Yeah. Yep.
But you have to have a secret in play while you play.
Yeah, that's why it works so well with Reno Mage.
Yeah.
It works well with
5 mana, 4/7 taunts.
With Medivh's Valet and this, you just play Ice Block and it just permanently synergizes with those cards. Yeah. I don't know. It's beautiful.
Yeah, this
card is beautiful. It's a Fugin with Taunt. It's crazy.
Yeah, it looks good too.
Yeah. It's an owl.
It looks all right. Hoot.
Rip hoot.
I just don't think. Do you think it's creative enough?
It's not that interesting, but it's good in that specific archetype.
Yeah, but Reno Mage really needed a really good taunt.
Yeah. It's sort of like Twilight Guardian for...
Yeah, exactly.
For Dragon X.
But you can't run the Twilight Guardian.
This is the Avian Watcher. I mean, this is the Twilight Guardian for Dragon X.
But it's even better.
Except it's for Reno decks, and it's permanently active. You don't even need a Dragon. You just need to play Ice Block, which is... I guess it's a more difficult condition to satisfy.
You have to get Ice Block.
You have to get that Ice Block and play it.
Off of Babbling
Brook. But once you play it... Once you play it... The Medivh's Valet and this card become crazy.
Yeah.
If they release even more synergy cards like related to it, they might run even more secrets just to increase the consistency of activating these cards.
Mm-hmm.
So, I like it.
Yeah.
All right. I don't like the card, but it's good.
It's okay. It's not amazing.
In the right decks.
Yeah. The next one is this card is, in my opinion, really, really strong. 6 mana, 3/6 Bookworm Battlecry. If you're holding a dragon, destroy an enemy minion with 3 or less attack, and it's also a dragon. This card is crazy.
It is crazy.
I don't think it's crazy.
In any dragon, it's like the Nether Sprite Historian, except it's like 6 mana.
Yeah.
The thing is, it costs 6 mana, so it's a little expensive.
But killing
it gives
three attack, it's targeted.
That's not special.
A Kodo.
Yeah, that's special.
It's not a Kodo.
Three attack is
Kodo
special.
Is random. This thing hits any like the exact minion that you want. And it's a dragon in itself. So I think this replaces... even in Dragon Warrior, the effect is so strong that even though this is not an aggressive card, it's a control type card, I would replace one of the Dragon and Crushers with this. Just because it gives
really?
You... Every single... Yeah, because Dragon and Crusher is more of like a... It's like a filler minion that's also a dragon, and it's aggressive.
Mm-hmm.
But often what happens is Dragon and Crusher isn't active. So with this card, you're probably going to have a dragon in your hand, and it's a dragon in itself.
But now you're considering your opponent has a minion with 3 or less attack.
There are... The majority of decks in the metagame.
Yeah, they do need it.
It's three or less attack. Yeah.
So let's compare it to Kodo. Kodo does its job, and it's very strong. This is like Kodo.
Kodo, except it's targeted, and it has the dragon tag.
And it also has plus one, like, attack one, to its,
Its condition. Toughness.
So I think this is better than Kodo in dragon decks. By far. Because it's targeted. And it activates your dragon's energy. It's like how people don't think, why would Deathwing be played in an aggressive deck like Dragon Warrior? It turns out that Deathwing is amazing in Dragon Warrior.
Because you're dumping your hand, you're really just like...
And even though it's a super late game card, it's still good. This is like the effect is... And he said Deathwing is the effect is so strong. This effect is also so strong and it's a dragon activator. And you don't have to wait... It's actually less situational than Deathwing because Deathwing requires you to like dump all your cards. The majority of decks have... three or less attack minions, and you just use this on turn 6 and kill one
right,
of those.
Right, here's where it falls flat. Say you're playing, like, a Dragon Warrior Mirror, and your opponent has, like a Blackwing Corruptor and a Draconic Crusher, and you have this in your hand. There's, like, you could have potentially no
if
target.
If they have those on their board, you're gonna lose anyways.
No, you could have played, like, a Draconic Crusher to at least contest the board, but this thing, it's, like, it's a 3-6 for 6 mana.
This thing demolishes Water
Elemental. So it needs to have a board, like, state... for it to do its thing.
You can say that about literally any
I know, but...
This effect is so powerful.
It's a situational card with a powerful effect.
That's like every single card in the game.
It's like Red Black Hand.
No, it's not like
Red Black Hand.
I know.
Yeah, and Red Black Hand's also not a dragon. It might actually be played if it was a dragon.
Yeah.
It might be played if Bed of the Legendary is being played.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So this card is good.
I don't think it's bonkers.
It's not bonkers. I think it's really good, though.
I think it's okay.
Yeah.
I think it's really good. Because the effect is just so strong, and there's like pretty much there's virtually no deck that doesn't have a 3 attack minion.
What's cool about it though is like if you consider it as a shadow
and it's targeted,
if it's a Shadowward Pain, then you're like you're paying 4 mana for a 3/6 and 2 mana for Shadowward Pain. Then it's pretty cool.
It's a dragon, and Shadowward Pain is a priest card.
Look, I know.
Yeah. So that's what's great about this card. Dragon.
Would you throw this in Dragon Priest?
But you know, you don't know because you think this card is okay and not really good. At the very least, it's good. It's good.
You're saying this with absolute confidence.
Yeah. I know for right now, I would just switch out one of my Draconic Crushers for this.
What if you're wrong?
No, it's good. It's just if you play in the metagame and you know that there's a lot of 3 attack minions, and in so many situations where you don't want to play a 6 mana 6 6, you want to play this. This is so much better than 6 mana 6 6.
I would play Crushers over this.
Okay, then you're not. You need a lesson in Dragon Warrior. Moving on!
I see you teach me something.
Alright, Moat Lurker. 6 mana 3/3. Battlecry, destroy a minion, death rattle, resummon it.
This card is beautiful.
It's so creative.
Ooh. Did you know it has synergy with an Azoth too?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh.
Because it's death rattle.
Did you know you can temporarily remove your opponent's minions?
I know.
Did you know they purify?
Purify!
Oh my god.
Yeah, there's a lot of things you can do with this.
How crazy would this card be if it resummoned the minion on your side?
Your opponent's?
Oh, yeah, that's what I thought initially.
That'd be insane. This would be 2 copies in any deck
They wouldn't design this card to do that.
That'd be too OP.
The main thing that comes to mind is using this on your own Sylvanas to get insane value out of Sylvanas.
And just get a new Sylvanas.
Yeah.
And you get basically the first Sylvanas effect. You activate it yourself. You get an additional Sylvanas, and you get a 3/3.
Yep.
Yeah. And it makes your minions stick.
You can also not target your own minions, just hit your opponent's minions that are being a threat right now.
You play Purify.
Well, you don't have to. Just kind of like just buy yourself a little bit of time.
Yeah. It's sort of like a freeze.
So it's got a lot of utility.
But then the thing is, this freeze is like it's more difficult for your opponent to get out of it because they have to kill it, and then there's like a they have to kill it, and then they can attack next turn with it.
Here's an interesting thought. So. What if you're a priest and you use Shadow Madness on your opponent's Moat Lurker, and then you kind of have it killed? And it
well, what happens? Wow.
Where does the minion go?
What the heck? No, because the text resummon it means it resummons wherever it came from.
It doesn't say that, though.
No, it is.
You're just assuming it.
No, it's not. It's confirmed that resummon is on the side that it came from. Yeah. So why would it matter which side it's on?
So even if you shadow magic, it's going to go back to wherever it's supposed to
be. Reading comprehension and logic skills.
It doesn't say it. It might have been programmed.
No, well, we know from developer tweets that...
You know this.
No, well, we
I guess I know this, too.
We know this, but then you, for some reason, you somehow derive the fact that, which side does it go on if you use Shadow Madness on it?
What if they programmed it in an interesting way where it doesn't, confirm to that? Where it's not about...
That's just a tech... That's
it's, like, a relative to, you know, wherever it was originally.
Well, that's an inconsistency, then. Because it clearly said that we already know that it resummons on the side that it was played.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
That's we know that that's
I can confirm that.
That's what we know that resummon it that we know what that text means.
Hey.
So that means if we shadow banish it, why does that change the text? If it does change the text, the inconsistency on Blizzard's end. Yeah. But, so I think this is a good card. Good in control decks.
Yeah, very
pretty
good.
Nuts.
Very good. Very good.
It's not nuts. It doesn't do anything.
Nuzoth summons it too.
It doesn't do anything absolutely unfair. That's the thing.
Yeah, the stats are like terrible, but for its effect, it's pretty decent.
The thing with Nuzoth is like when it summons this, does it summon like when in death rattle? Does it resummon the minion that it killed originally?
No, yes. It's just a 3/3.
It's just a 3/3.
Here's the thing. It destroys the minion, so that counts for the Nuzoth tick. So if you destroy Sylvanas with this, and then this thing gets destroyed, and then the Sylvanas is back and that dies, Nuzoth will summon both Sylvanas and this thing.
No, I think it's just summon
this thing.
Through.
No, it summon this thing, but will the new thing summon another Sylvanas?
Oh, the new Moat Lurker?
No, I don't think so.
No, of course. That would be a buff.
Yeah, it's just a vanilla 3/3.
It'd just be a 3/3. That's still better than nothing.
You can put in a shadow step.
No. You could argue that you don't want a 6-mana 3/3 because it'll dilute your Nuzoth pool. And then if you're running more than 6 Death Rattle minions, then it'll make your pool worse.
Yeah, worse. Yes. Yeah.
But I guess you're fine summoning a full board. It doesn't really matter.
Yeah, true.
Yeah. Still a good card. I like it. And the next card is the... Oh, are we done?
I think we're at
the... And we're done, yeah.
And we're done.
Oh, wow. All right. How exciting.
Yeah, how exciting.
Oh, these cards are really, really fun.
Yeah.
Damn.
Yeah, just by glancing over the expansion earlier, I didn't think. Like, I thought a lot of the. I just like looked over them and I didn't think they were that good.
Well, from the very beginning, the first few cards they released, they were very uninteresting.
Yeah, and then having so that sort of like set the tone for the rest of the expansion.
Yeah,
I think they should have released some of the cards that they released at the end of the beginning just to get people hyped. But after like thoroughly analyzing these cards and like discussing them, I'm really excited for the rest of this expansion.
Yeah. Yeah. Definitely.
Till we realize that discard warlock is the new cancer and we don't want to play anymore.
It's not that consistent though, that's the thing. And like sometimes it just falls flat on the floor when it just cards the wrong cards.
Perhaps, yeah.
So what are your predictions for this expansion? Like what decks other than discard warlock, what do you think will pop up? I think Beastry is gonna be one. I think dragon decks are gonna be one.
I actually don't think Beastry will be that strong. But people will try it out.
I'm gonna fall in love with Reno Mage.
Reno
Mage is gonna be big.
Nuzoth Pally might make a comeback solely because of Barnes. Because Barnes is like a four-drop Tyrion. Four-drop Ray.
Barnes is gonna be everywhere.
Four-drop Cairn. Four-drop Sylvanas.
A lot of decks.
Yeah.
It's gonna be Doctor 4.
Doctor 4. Yeah.
And yeah. Any last words?
Okay, well, any shout-outs?
Any shout-outs?
Yeah. Well, I guess you can follow me at twitch.tv/JohnAdrianLee. And I don't have a Twitter because I don't use Twitter.
You can follow me on my Twitter. It's Kraxximus.
@Kraxximus.
at twitter.com.
Yeah, and this will be the end of One Night in Karazhan card review. I hope you guys enjoyed it. If you guys enjoyed it, definitely leave a like, comment, and subscribe. And if you don't like it, put a dislike and explain to us why you don't like it, and we improve it in the future as well. So
yeah, flame us so that we can get angry and
he will write down in the comments and flame you. So.
Yeah, flame specifically this guy.
Yeah,
because he makes bad predictions.
Yeah. Don't do that. No, what?
Yeah, he's also an angry kid. Although he's older than me.
Apparently.
Oh, what's up?
What's up?
Yeah, what's up?
Oh, man.
Oh, what's up?
Yeah, and we'll see you guys next time.